first point on the agenda is to give the oath of office to Carol Balfe, our president-to-be again.
I do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States of America and the Constitution of the State of New York, and that I will faithfully discharge the duties of the office of president of the Board of Education of the Canajoharie Central School District according to the best of my ability. Agenda. Next are questions and comments from the floor. I wasn't here, but from what I saw in the video and then the questions that were put to me, there were certainly some that were personal that don't belong in a public forum like this to be responded to, I don't believe.
There was one.
The other stuff that would be, not stuff, I don't mean it that way.
It's okay.
items that would require any kind of response from the board are generally going to be covered under old business. So that's part of our agenda on a regular basis now to kind of circle back to old business.
That, I'm sorry. That it would, so when it says under old business, like that would be the time we're going to address those questions?
Exactly. Right. Anything that would need a response that was a public kind of response to, you know, a general question about, I don't know, pick a topic, you know, the class rank, of course, or
so like
the scheduling or something that needed to be reviewed by staff members or whatever it might be, would come back under old business.
Okay, so dumb question. So, like, some of the questions that I had were things that I had brought up a few meetings before, and they weren't addressed under old business in future meetings. Like, is there a way to communicate to the public that the board will be responding to the issues of whatever, so, you know, like, let's say Mr. Hill's question about the prom. He had a question about, like, how does the public know, oh, tonight we're going to get those answers, or so we can anticipate?
Again, I would expect it to be under old business unless it was responded to that particular person through a letter or whatever it might have been, a telephone conversation or whatever it might be.
So, but again, like, when I did have those questions prior to that, they weren't addressed, like, how. So I guess maybe if those, like, I probably wouldn't have had those questions, a couple of those questions, if they had been addressed in prior meetings. So, like, how could we all know? That's, I guess that's right. How can we all get the information and be able to respond as a community?
I think there are two. I think the board next week is having a retreat, and I think that communication will likely be part of what the board may choose to discuss. And thinking about how to more prompt, in my head, it's how do we more promptly respond to people, either individuals or the community or whoever needs to be responded to in a little bit more of a prompt fashion. So I think the board can discuss that and come up with some different strategies. I've got some ideas to share with them for their consideration.
Okay. So can we expect as a community that if the question comes up in public, that it will be informative? Even though, like, even if you respond to the person individually, that the answers to those questions can be in a public response, so that everybody has an information. Like, that was, you gave some really detailed information. I don't want to have to go to 20 people and say, here, read that, and then I just think of it. Anyway, so it sounds like you guys have a plan. Mm-hmm.
I can only speak for me. I think it's critical that those questions in public be responded to in public with the information, so that everybody has the same information.
Excellent, I do too. So should I hold off in sharing that information that you emailed me?
The correspondence was with you. I'm prepared to do it tonight as well.
Okay. So I just have one little clarification about my Bassett question. When I saw the Bassett program or whatever, I was under the assumption it was the one that you guys had been talking about, or the community. So the one that...
Well, we voted on last month.
That's not the... This is just for having the doc.
Correct.
I got it. So,
correct.
So
it was just the regular assumption.
Okay. Thank
15-16 Kendrick rate target data.
If you would take one and pass it down, please, because I wasn't sure it would be visible enough on the screen. So last year, we embarked on a two-year process called Results First. And Results First is a process that we started. It's a multi-year process. And the idea of it is to help schools through the use of teams, develop some targets, develop some ways to look at student performance and act quickly. So it's target, data, action, target, data, action, target, data, action. So last year we presented, these targets, the teams. Year one is really getting the Results First teams organized and working. We have teams at the elementary, middle, and secondary level. They did their work, and we have to report out, obviously, on the targets. So this is the end of year data collection and results for our Results First targets for 15-16. We had mixed success, and that's okay for year one. You get on the path with some things. So probably the target that is the most celebratory, at least for me, they all are, but this one, which was to increase graduation rate for students who are economically disadvantaged and students with disabilities by 10%. We met both of those targets by 10% or more. The information is there. So we improved graduation rates for economically disadvantaged students to 79% if we round up using standard rounding measures. And we had 100% of our students with disabilities graduate this year. And that's a great achievement. Our second one was to increase proficiency and mastery rates on Regents exams by 5%. Yeah.
So is the 2015 number the actual for the year before?
Yes. The second target was to increase proficiency and mastery rates on the Regents exams by 5%. We had a partial success on this one. We had three Regents exams that met the target, and the rest were close or still working on it. And I do want to put a footnote under the Algebra 2 trig test, because this was the first year of the Common Core Algebra 2 trig test, and you can't compare apples to oranges. So that's a hard one to measure because we don't have a comparison for it. And Ms. Gleason's going to talk a little bit more about the Regents exams in a little bit, so she'll have some more information on that. Our next target was to decrease secondary course failures by 10%. There was no significant improvement at either the middle school level or the high school level on this goal. The positive spin on it didn't get any worse. but it also didn't get any significant improvement. So that's one that we have spent some time talking about and thinking about how can we creatively support students so that we are reducing that course failure rate. It pretty much has stayed the same as the data that the board has looked at for the past few years. The student growth scores on the 3-8 ELA and math assessments, that student growth is still being calculated. Those scores were just released last week, and I want to just put a little footnote here. Student growth does not mean who passed it. It's looking at the students who took the assessment from one grade level to the next and their growth. So it's the individual student growth. And then the last one was from East Hill, which was to increase K-3 reading literacy levels by 10%. And again, this was a partial. We had some grade levels that did and exceeded, and some that are still moving forward towards that target. So what we will be looking at for year two is establishing some different sets of targets. Some will, the course failure one will remain the same. It may be reworked a little bit. Also to include course successes. So we're going to work on those, and then in year two, you take the teams, and the teams start to branch out to more people and get more teachers involved. So it's that growing model of how can we set targets around students, how can we measure those targets, and then be quicker to action. So that we'll be looking forward to doing that. Two stumbling blocks we had this year was around being quicker to action and also looking at the data on a quarterly basis. So those are two improvements that we will be making and have made. So that's just a wrap up of year one. And we'll begin that process again with the next school year.
I haven't seen the data that you referred to.
Right.
Is there a reason why we're just not putting the results with this versus just yes or no?
Yeah, I have it. I have it to give to you as well. This was just the overview because we'll want to put the data. We're not done with all the data sets yet.
Okay. And then the other question I had was on the first one, the increase of graduation rate, how are you measuring 10%? Total population, percentage growth?
We're looking at those two subgroups, so students who are economically disadvantaged, which is 50% of our
combined?
Student body.
Combined, okay.
Yes, so it's in the cohort that's graduating. So we're looking at last year we had 75% graduation rate for that cohort, so our goal was 10% above that. And then for students with disabilities, that's a separate cohort.
Of 75% would be 7.5%. That's why I was asking.
Oh, so maybe I didn't put the right math there. Oh, so that would be a partial then.
And then those numbers in parentheses under the disabilities is the number of students?
Yes.
Which varies year to year.
Yes.
Also, though.
The economically disadvantaged student, that number, the 78.5, is actually hand calculated because Ms. Gleason and I sat down and figured it out. Luckily, we have a small number of students, so we could do that. We'll have to wait till State Ed gets their official verified numbers, which will be in a year. It takes them a year to get us the verified information.
And so now the next step is we're going to keeping the percentage is the same for this next group. If we're going to do a comparison, we want to see the same targets reached, and we want to see another 10% improvement here, 5% here, 10% here, 5% here.
We have a slightly varied set of targets for next year based upon where we were successful and where we were not. So we're going to revise those targets a little bit.
Going to bring that to us sometime.
Yep. Those will be on opening day. Like last year, I talked about these on opening day. It'll be the same thing this year,
okay.
And then bring them to the board meeting following that.
Gotcha.
Thank you.
I also observed the 10%.
Yeah, thank you.
But my thing I'm concerned about is the course failure rate.
Mm-hmm.
And what I would really like to request is that have some kind of a more detailed report about what has been tried, what do we think is really the cause of it. We've talked about things like that it's not people do okay on tests but don't submit their homework, or, you know, what I'd like to see more of an analysis of why it is that we seem to be stuck in this rut. Because this has been ongoing for a number of years now. And, you know, it's kind of discouraging to see this kind of a situation. And so I'd like to really get more of an in-depth analysis of it. Not that we want those failure reports every month again, but, you know, just something with more meat in it to mm-hmm. give us a sense of what's being done, how we're tackling it, mm-hmm. how we plan to tackle it, and so mm-hmm. forth. And what do we think is contributing to it. Mm-hmm.
Shows that there's specific courses that are problematic, mm-hmm. that would be helpful too. Maybe that would allow us to put special emphasis on certain things, stuff like that.
So more to come in September. Fix my math problem.
Anything further? Next we have the draft superintendent goals.
So this is in paper format because it is just a handout to think about, because the board retreat is next week. So the final goals that I will have for 16-17 will certainly come from the board retreat next week. So thinking about categories, there are four main categories that I am thinking about right now based on the work that the board has already done: communication, development, and that's personnel and program development, learning, and then the category of other, because there's always other things going on. With the board's vision process that'll start in the fall, there will be a high need for communication on both the vision process and the outcomes of that process, as well as continuing to use multiple media sources to tell our story. And I think that's really helpful. There's a lot of great things going on. We always try to push the positive. We have quite a great following on Facebook. We have a little bit of a following on Instagram, and we have some ideas, Craig Clark and I, about how to boost that. Twitter's moving right along. We will also have a district app next year, because in the world of people today, that's one of the primary sources of information that people expect. So we are working with, Craig and I are working just to get things started with the BOCES communication service, and once we get the structure around that, other people will be involved in that implementation. And then the last thing is really to start talking about, or to start implementing a blog, from my perspective, using both some infographics, pictures of things, because believe it or not, if it can't be a 30 to 60 second read, people aren't looking at it. True. And multimodal text, which is a little bit of explanation, but maybe with a video, or again, something quick hit that people might want some more information about. I've had some requests for some different topics, or people have approached me in the community wanting to know more about some things. It seems to be a really good way to do that. Under the development piece, we have to look at our professional development plan. There are new regulations out there, and so we really want to look at professional development and supporting teachers. We have to do some work in the area of technology, and we also have to start looking at how to secure some other resources and develop some other partnerships to support both the building and the teacher level innovations that are going on. And again, this is all draft to be determined and fleshed out more based on the outcomes of the board retreat. There also then in the learning area, we have year two of the Kanjo Great targets and the processes, and starting to build those out a little bit, because that whole results first is go slow to go fast. And then supporting innovations at both the teacher and the building level. And you know, we have some things going on with conscious discipline and project-based learning and the ninth grade initiative and some other things. In the other category, we have our solar project that will be starting soon. And then continuing to look at economic development support. I was just asked this week by the county to write a letter in support of a grant, an EPA grant, to take a look at the Beechnut property and the Beechnut site. So it's continuing to partner with both the village and the town and the county to, in whatever small way the schools can, help support their initiatives. So this is the starter list. And we'll come back to this list pending the outcomes of the board retreat next week. So mull it over, give it some thought.
We'll be getting some advanced materials for the board.
Yes, yes. That's tomorrow. Because you have some homework to do. Next, we have our discussion items, the second meeting agenda topics. Some notes. Can you see that, everybody? So there are 2, 4, 6, 7 second meetings. The first two have some considerations with them. The 9/22 date is 2 days before the Grimshaw wedding.
Are you going to be here that day?
Probably not. So I would ask respectfully that the board consider perhaps we look at that date, since that is right before my son's wedding. And on October 27th, part of a conversation later is about attendance at the New York State School Boards Association conference, and that second meeting date is during the conference days. All the rest of the days are fine. So perhaps that can be conversations just in terms of the dates at the retreat next week. But I did want to open up the opportunity to talk or at least brainstorm some potential topics. One that would be very interesting, and we just had a meeting with our librarians yesterday, would be to talk about library services. The second one that just came to my mind right now was the federal Every Student Succeeds Act and what that means and what's in that document. But certainly there are other things that you might want to learn more about.
How do you go higher?
I can see it in your face. Come on.
Well, one thing.
List.
One thing. I was at a rural school boards conference recently, and one of the interesting things that came out of it is they talked about, you know, pre-K and all that, but even working with kids from 0 to 3 years old. But one of the things that was to me really fascinating was they were talking about not only working with the kids, but working with the parents of the kids to help them to better prepare their kids for school. And, you know, it was a new concept to me. I've never heard that before. And so I would like to really hear more about that and how maybe we could use some of our community school money in that, you know, for that type of direction, because, you know, there was a superintendent there from the middle of the state who really, you know, talked about it being a tremendous boost for their ability to get kids to do better and to succeed. So that's one thing that I. Another thing that I would like to hear more about would be how we're dealing with behavioral issues in the school, and you know, what can be done to make that more productive and positive. You know, one of the concepts again that came at this rural school board thing is that consequences do not solve problems, and so I'd like to see more of a, you know, an exploration of that, and how can we help solve problems rather than just have consequences that kind of are a repeat loop in many cases.
And since Ms. Ward is not here, I will say that when the work gets started with the conscious discipline work that they're doing, that would be a great place to start with more information about that.
So maybe that's something we're doing earlier.
Another thing that I might suggest we learn about, I think the program is called Pathways.
Yep.
So that we kind of come up to speed on what's going on.
Okay, the Pathways. Did you say Pathways? Yeah. retreat list, yep.
One other thing that I think should be part of every at least every second meeting agenda, if not every agenda, should be a report from a student representative on issues that have come up in the school that they wanted to bring to the board.
I forewarned them that that might be something that they need to be.
Most definitely.
That's the perfect opportunity to do that.
Yep. Excellent.
And so I think that should be just like kind of
a standing item
on the agenda. So that.
So like reports on issues, reports on things kids want to see, and like their voice?
You're the voice of the student body. So, you know, basically bringing to the board any concerns that you have or that you are expressed to you by students, both in terms of questions or concerns or complaints or difficulties or whatever it might be.
Maybe we can find a good way for your student body to funnel those things to you, whether there's like literally a suggestion box of sorts or, you know what I mean? Like a way, because the students aren't used to having this opportunity either. So, but a way for you to collect information from your fellow students. That
right.
Sounds like it's gonna be important too.
Yeah, I mean, Carolyn can work together on that.
Yeah, we can come up with some ways that people can make sure they get thoughts, ideas, stuff to you guys. So that you then can share it out.
Mm-hmm. And you thought this would be easy.
What comes next week? Next we have the Regents exam results.
Yes.
Talking some about, especially with the results first. Mark, like you were saying in regards to how are we looking at those course failures and really judging one from the other, especially now that we're talking about students not just automatically moving from freshman to sophomore unless they have those credits, right? So then what do we do to the class there if we're maintaining those? So when I look at the numbers and I think from 2007 until now, each cohort size we get in is different too. So one of the things, I know we're looking at percentages, but we know that as our class sizes get smaller, then each number, each person, means more to that percentage. So I think we're gonna have to come up with some different ways too to look at this information as we continue to sort of judge, are we getting more percentage-wise of our students to challenge the upper level Regents exams, and are we then moving more of those students to mastery? Because those are our two goals. So as Mrs. Grimshaw already mentioned, the Common Core ELA and the US History exams are two places where we saw high percentages of students achieving a mastery or better, that 85 or better. And in discussing some of the things that we think for that particular group, aside from our stellar juniors, is also that both of those teachers participated, Mr. Smith and Mrs. Simmons, in the College Ready Writing Project that just gave them some different ideas, some different thoughts about how we do some of those things, how we do some of that writing for information. And also in the case of Mrs. Simmons, she was on our results first team, and when the students took the January exam, we looked at some of those individual protocols. She had students set goals, talk about what they did achieve, what they could do better. And so I think that was a real asset where that exam was concerned too. And we had a lot of students who did great the first time around. So not to downplay that, but those students who set goals. I think some of our students who the first time got in the 70s were able to achieve on the second time up 85 or better, which moved those students into that mastery category. And I think that's a big deal, because our kids really went in that second time and went after it and tried to reach those goals and had very specific things they were trying to do better.
Was there some program that was instituted between the first exam and the second exam?
Well, during the entirety of the year, they were doing the College Ready Writing Project. So they were working on those skills, and they continued to work with the leadership from that group to perfect those plans and to work together to build lessons and things like that. So they continued to work on that throughout the course of the year. I think one thing that was different that Mrs. Simmons did was to stop and have each of the kids look at their results from that exam and then set their own targets. What do you need to do better to get to that? So if you got a 70 and you want an 85, how do you get there?
And then were there independent plans for each student?
Well, the students did set what their goals were and what they needed to do to get there.
Okay.
And then that helped to inform, obviously, how she worked with students as they moved forward on the individual projects. And it was after the January test that they did their civics project, which was more project-based learning, when they ended up doing their presentations for the other group. So I think it was very active in that second half of the year for them. And so that's part of a conversation, too, we have to have with Mrs. Simmons to see, like, what are her thoughts about the things she did differently and how it worked and where does she want to go with it for our students moving forward.
Speaking from the student standpoint, I was in Ms. Simmons' class, and I think she did a very good job with getting us more involved in the class rather than some people float out to the side. We really didn't have as much students float out to the side. Most of our kids in my class, at least, were heavily involved in like you said, the civics project, and she would have us write like argumentative essays. A lot of different types of essays throughout the year to help us prep for like the January regions and the regions of June.
Yeah. But because some of it connected back to those topics of interest to you guys, I think that made the writing more realistic for them.
Mm-hmm.
And so, as I said, Mr. Smith also participated in some of the College Ready writing work. And I know we've talked about the ways that informs some of the writing he does with his students as well for the essays in U.S. history. And again, you know, we had 60% of our students hit mastery on the U.S. history exam, which is great. So those were sort of our high spots. I think we still, and it will be hard to tell at first because obviously we're not going to increase the Algebra 2 numbers until we increase the geometry numbers. So until we get a higher percentage of our students challenging the geometry regions, we're not going to get a higher number of students challenging the Algebra 2.
Can I just ask a question? It's probably a stupid question, but like for Algebra 2, it has 15 and 16 on the regions, and it has percentages, and then the Common Core Algebra 2 has much better percentages. What is the difference between those two?
Well, this was the first year of the Common Core Algebra 2 exam. So the content, the curriculum changed to match the Common Core, and they allowed students to still take the Algebra 2 trig. However, there's material on the Algebra 2 trig that is no longer on the Algebra 2, the Common Core Algebra 2. So we had students take it to see how they would do, but I think the real test of what they learned in the course was the Common Core Algebra.
So that's much more encouraging.
Yeah. Yes. Our students did better on the Common Core Algebra, which was their focus during the course of the year. Now they're phasing that exam out, the Algebra 2 trig, more quickly than they did the Integrated Algebra. Remember, like they kept saying nobody was going to be able to take it, but they kept offering the Integrated Algebra. We are now in the days of there's no more Integrated Algebra, it's just Common Core. We're done with the geometry, it's just Common Core. And now the thing that just came out, they're doing the retake of the Algebra 2 trig for those kids, but next June it will just be the Common Core Algebra 2. So those have all pretty much phased out now. And then we will be able to focus on how our students do. Because, you know, our students are doing okay in those Common Core exams, but like you can see the mastery levels are not. But the things we also talk about is, in terms of the way those are graded and the, you know, they get the results and then they do the chart to determine how many wrong get you this much grade. And so I think sometimes the students can be at a little bit of a disadvantage because they're really trying to make sure enough kids get over the hump and pass. And so sometimes that hurts the kids at the high end. You know what I mean? As they configure all of that and come up with their passing numbers and do all their charts. So again, our goal is still going to be to get, and Mrs. Prime, I've talked about students taking 4 years of math, students taking 4 years of science, getting more of our students to sit for the Algebra 2 exam, getting more of our students to take chemistry and to challenge that Regents exam. Because if you look at our number of students taking it, when you think about the fact that most of our advanced students coming out of middle school go right into biology and then go right into chemistry. So when you look at a number like 43, that tells me that a lot most of the students taking it are those that were advanced in ninth grade. We have very few kids who come into the high school and are taking earth science, biology, chemistry. They're choosing other avenues for their third science, which is okay, but we still want to encourage our kids to take the most challenging material in front of them and the most challenging exams and go after those advanced Regents diplomas. That's our goal. So, those are the areas we still have to work on, I think, and I've said this before, in terms of Mrs. Lenz meeting with students and doing one-on-one program planning and talking to them about their college goals and their goals after high school, I think we'll see those numbers increase. I also think we're starting the use of Naviance this year, which has a great career inventory on it, and it connects that career to what the students need to do in their coursework in order to be prepared for those college programs. I think we'll start to move our kids in that direction, taking more of those exams.
Do we have a goal of what we desire our student level of mastery to be in each of these courses?
Well, you know, we want all of our kids to be college and career ready, so I want it to be 100% of our kids at mastery.
Well, I don't think that's realistic, but
I'm still going to shoot for it.
Okay, so we want the 85 plus to be 100 number as our target.
I want, right, because what they're saying, right, what New York State is saying, is in order to be college and career ready, you have to hit mastery on these assessments that they think are the benchmark for that. Now, I agree with you. Are we going to get 100% of our kids to that place? Maybe not, but I think that's what we shoot for, because I want all of our kids to leave here college and career ready. So I'm not sure that these tests are the best measure of that, but for right now, it's what we have. So our goal is to move all of our students to mastery on the topics that currently are being measured to determine that.
To give you an update on what we've learned about the community schools aid, there's a guidance document that's available for folks to take a look at about what we can use the community schools aid for, and it isn't very much different than the original guidance that we received, which is really around supporting academic health, mental health, counseling, dental care, nutrition, legal services, other services to students and their families. And so as we're considering the $78,000 that we got in set aside aid, we are looking first at the need that arose last year, which is really to provide crisis mental health services for children and their families. We talked about this a lot last year, that we really have had a small explosion, as most of the districts around us have, with students and families dealing with crisis mental health issues. And so some of the funds, we are working with the Family Counseling Center to consider a partnership that will provide the service and a mental health worker to support students, families, and assist our teachers in working with those students coming to us with trauma-based behaviors. Because that's different. That is a need that we have identified last year, and that we really need to pay attention to that. So that use of funds is appropriate. It comes under the guidance document number 2, health, mental health, and counseling and dental care. It would be a new contract for the district for licensed and certified professional providers of the service. The remainder of the funds, that doesn't chew up all the money. That does not use up all the money.
Is that a one-time additional aid, or are we anticipating that? Do we have any guidance on whether this is a breakout that the state is trying to take a different trend to or not?
You have learned quickly, Mr. Ferguson, about state aid and funding this past week, so thank you for that question. We were surprised. This was a surprise last year in the budget for when the governor released his budget for schools to have this community schools aid money. So we don't know the answer to that question yet. What we were advised to do was to set it aside. It's built into the foundation aid, but we were advised to set it aside. So we did that, and then tried to make use of it to try and provide more comprehensive services to students. I would hope that if we start doing some of these things, that the state would continue to support us so we can continue them for students.
Yeah, I was really just asking to know, there's a different way to approach how to use that aid, whether you do expenses on a contractual basis,
right,
or you increase your own resources. I mean, there's different,
right,
ways of looking at it depending on what we think that money is going,
yes,
to be.
I think the best, for the crisis mental health services, because that work requires some specialized kind of certification, and because we don't have the answer to that question yet, I think the contractual piece is a great way to start. It also puts us, part of this also is that the expectation is that schools are partnering with other agencies. So one of the things we did look at is, could we provide a basic help here in the school? We looked at that. That was cost prohibitive, at least in terms of the community schools aid. So then in looking at what other needs do we have, the one that clearly emerged last year was really around crisis mental health services for students and families. And that is definitely a need that we have. The other pieces that it can work towards is, Mark, what you offered, so I added that already to the notes, looking at how to work with families and young children, and the PPS team is working on creating a parent family room down at East Hill, which we should probably put that on our list of things to talk about. But certainly we could use some community schools aid money to support that. It also can be used for extended day programs before and after school, and we do know that that's a need, and so we're kind of looking at how might we do some extended day programs for students as well. And then that will be all the $78,000 that we got.
Has there been any discussion about what type of extended day programs we're thinking about, or not yet?
A little bit. Some folks at East Hill had a conversation just earlier this week, some of the teachers, a conversation about how they might like to extend a pilot that they did that was at the beginning of the day that helps students kind of come in, get set for school, because some of them are there quite early. We also need to look at, when we're looking at student success in school, not all students have the opportunity to go home and complete homework or coursework at home, so we're also looking at the middle and high school level, how those extended day programs help students do what they need to do, or can we think about how to use time during the day, resources during the day, if you have to go home and take care of younger siblings or there's some other impact on your life. So yes, we're having those conversations.
And then at the same time, this was a new line item on the budget, so can we count on it being there next year?
We don't.
Who knows?
I hope so.
We'll take it for now.
We're looking at these initiatives as pilots to see, and we will evaluate their effectiveness and their support. I think the bottom line, though, is the trend from the state regarding schools is that we have a larger role to play in supporting students than just the education in the classroom. And we are a social service agency. And this is, to me, tangible evidence that the state is moving in that direction.
The Finance Committee met this week at Leah's request, as she was, you've got all these notes in front of you, finishing her 15-16 fiscal year numbers and was right on target. The state decided to do something novel, and you can see up there, they sent us $425,000. Of which she was not expecting 227 of that. And we have to account for it in last year's budget. So, as she was calculating numbers on what that potentially does, if we leave it in general fund, which is at this point what our suggestion is, it changes what our fund balance is going to be. Because we were on target to reduce it, and this doesn't put it in that direction at this point. So, a couple of things for our recommendations. After the budget was done last, you know, as we talked about the budget for next year, and what it's going to be to the tax rate in the village, or for not just the village, but for all the taxpayers in our district, we were potentially going to put the tax levy at zero instead of a potential increase, which was rather small.
I'm assuming you mean the tax levy increase at zero.
Right.
Correct. Yes. Right. Yes. Sorry. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, no, not the tax levy itself. No. Tax levy increase at zero. But at that point, you know, it was a relatively small amount, the tax levy increase itself, 0.23%. I think it worked out to about $15,000 or something to that effect. But at this point, we don't need that. We talked about using the RS, and that came up a number of times in our discussions on our what our fiscal plan is for reserve funds and such, and at this point, we don't need to use it. That doesn't really help us either because we wanted to use some of that fund. One of our big problems, and this has come up many, many times, is what's going to happen with the Beachnut property. And as much as we talk about it, it's still a big elephant in the room because we don't know. We're pretty sure, after discussion with as many people as we could reach, that the county is going to take ownership. Assuming that happens, which we're pretty sure is going to happen, then it comes off the tax roll. And the Beachnut property was roughly $188,000 in school tax. Which would basically chew up everything they just gave us. Not all of it, but most of it.
So since the Finance Committee met on Tuesday, I was able to have today, a conversation with the town assessor who was able to confirm that the property's coming off the tax rolls because the county has temporary jurisdiction over it right now. So I contacted again the county treasurer's office and left a message for the county treasurer to call me back because the question now becomes the property, right, won't be taxed, will the county make us whole? They've made us whole for the past 3 years in terms of the tax levy. They are no longer required to do that.
And next year, because it's coming off off the tax roll, it won't be an issue because it'll get spread to the rest of taxpayers from a school tax perspective.
So we're trying to make sure we have all that information accurate. Because if indeed that it comes off the rolls and the county doesn't make it whole and it isn't dispersed among the other taxpayers, then that's a $188,000 hole in the budget, in the revenue budget.
But the 227 would cover that.
Yes.
Correct.
Well,
that would be a huge blessing in disguise.
The note under the numbers for the general aid and the excess cost aid indicate that the general money, aid money must be used in last year's budget.
No, it has to be attributed, accounted for in last year's budget. It doesn't have to be used, but when Leah does the accounting, it has to go under the books in 15-16. Even though we didn't get this final aid report for 15-16 until July 25th.
So it's going to raise our fund balances for 15-16.
Right. You know, we were on track before this. She was expecting the 198, which would make our budget
right.
Where she was anticipating our budget with the reduction in the fund balance, and if all the numbers were done until that happened,
so,
on July 25th.
So we would be able, that $227,000 will be able to be used however we need to use it.
Yes,
yes.
Because now it's going to go into unrestricted fund balance, which is going to pop that number up. And part of the reason why it's a challenge to use the ERS funds is because if you do that, then in the calculations of all the reserves, that actually would raise the unrestricted fund balance more.
So
right now we're going to sit on it, but
well,
it doesn't help.
Well, our recommendation
yeah.
to the board was, as we met as a finance committee, was to go to the zero tax increase, which again doesn't help much on the money number of our general fund going up by the $227,000. But because we don't know about the school tax from the county, whether they're going to pay it or not, keep us whole, that would cover it so we don't have a hole in our budget. And concurrently, we suggested looking at some other alternatives in terms of uses for the money. But until we know an answer of what happens with the county paying for those school taxes, we don't expend any of it. That was our recommendation to the board. So we're covered, no tax levy increase, and it allows us to make some decisions, but at the same time, we can gather the information of things that we would need and could spend the money.
When can we reasonably expect to know this information from the county?
I left a message today with the county treasurer's office. I'll reach out to them again next week. He's out of the office until next week, and I'll start calling next week.
Now, there's an implication. We have to act on the resolution for the tax levy. Tax levy change to take effect, which is why we're, as a finance committee, we were making that recommendation to the board.
Which was the way of items to approve.
Just so everybody understands
right.
what we're talking
from.
About.
Right? Any questions about that? I mean, more to commerce, kind of in the bowl, I guess.
I'll keep everyone posted when I hear from Mr. Bowerman and have a conversation. If I get any updated information, I'll let everybody know. Keep it current.
Okay, next we have items for approval. Ms. from July 14. Entertaining motion.
Motion to approve.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? I'll abstain. Budget transfers. Any motion on this as well?
Motion.
Thank you. Discussion on this. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Next are bills, general federal school lunch. Need a second, folks?
Yes, on this one.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Pretty soon you'll know I'm looking at you, right? Discussion on this. You want to pass? Are you sure?
Yeah. What? Okay. Can I ask a question?
Absolutely.
Just because I don't know what it is.
Okay.
The NY44 health.
That's our health insurance. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that's for the employees?
Yes. That's employees, yeah.
Okay, well, here it is. It's on page 7.
It's paid in multiple months over the course of the year. I'm sorry, page 7?
Yeah, page 7.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. What's the story about reimbursing PTEC for supplies?
It's coming out of the grant. So what exactly would we be spending that kind of money on?
Well,
what you're asking?
It's grant.
I'm just so confused by it.
Right,
because we are the LEA, the fiscal LEA for the grant. So we will have expenditures to the expenditures, but the funding source is the grant. It's not our district funds. So what Leah just offered you was to let you know that we had used some of the grant money, but we did have bills to pay from the grant for the CAD designs and for some of the PTEC supplies.
This is not our budget money going
No,
this is the grant money.
This is the Ag PTEC grant money.
Okay.
She just wanted you to know that so that you could see that it was a different funding stream. Is the treasurer's report from June. And we need a motion on this.
Motion.
Second.
Discussion on this one. Scott, we have constant bickering amongst ourselves about the interest earned on some of these accounts. So if you're looking at that, you go, oh my God. Yeah.
It's about $45 more than it was.
Yes. But you know, in particular, we've investigated potentially putting some funding in different types of accounts that
higher interest yielding.
There's unfortunately too many restrictions on what can happen with money that are in school accounts, and this is about as good as we can do, sadly.
And we're comfortable that's not the investment vehicle that's telling us that.
Yeah. There's regulations on what can happen. Oh, yeah.
I don't need to say anything, just be repetitive.
Maybe not to me.
Well, stick around.
That's been a thorn in our side for many, many years. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Next is the 16-17 HFM BOCES base contract. We need a motion on this?
Motion to approve.
All right, second.
Hold on. You gotta start paying attention down here because I'm looking at you. Discussion, go ahead.
By calling it base contract, what do we mean by that?
That means that's the first contract that we have with them throughout the year. Sometimes there will be additions or subtractions from the contract. Usually not subtractions, usually we'll add something. An example of that may be that we budget for X number of students in specialized programs. Sometimes we have students move in or there is a need that we would need to add a student to a specialized program. So the first contract is considered the base.
But this is still covering all aspects of the services that BOCES
yes.
gives to us, right?
Yes. And it's only a slight increase from the past couple of, from 15-16. We've worked hard to really evaluate the services we use with BOCES and make adjustments as necessary so that contract has stayed relatively stable.
Did anyone calculate the percentage increase they're charging us?
I don't know if Leah had done that or not.
I'm just wondering.
But I can
they're
ask
increasing their budget compared to what the rest of school districts are.
Right. The administrative budget they hold at 2%, which the board votes on in the spring. The program budget, I'm not sure, but I'll ask Mrs. Schaefer that question when she returns, and then she can get you that information.
But this is all student services. Administrative budget is
the administrative budget's in there, right? But it's
yeah,
in here.
One
it's
line
in here.
Somewhere. I'm just not finding it right now.
Right, it is. The administrative budget is in there. They've held that to 2% for the past 4 years.
I just have a couple of questions on some of the line items. On the first page, 625.000, the second line item. What is health, safety, risk management based on? What are we paying for with that?
That provides services that Gary utilizes for OSHA trainings or other health and safety risk trainings, consultation with their health, safety, risk manager. So we've had her in. She comes in and does things and takes a look at certain issues that are going on. She also provides us with our AED CPR training sometimes. So it's a variety of different services.
AED,
yeah, that's AED, the automatic external defibrillator, CPR.
Question.
I'm not done.
No, following on that same topic. A lot of insurers will do the things you listed for free. Is that not our case?
No. You mean insurers as in
whoever
our insurance folks?
Whoever is giving us risk management coverage.
They do some other things. So they'll do, like our Utica National does, the playground inspections. They do some other things.
Okay.
So it's not a cross or a duplication of services. That was the word I was trying to find.
Sorry, it was on your
screen. Okay, no, you're fine. second one on page 2, about the fourth one down, VoIP telephone solution, Capital Region. What are we paying for with that?
That's our phone service.
So we don't have a direct contract with Time Warner?
No. Well, we use Time Warner's lines, but NARIC provides us with the voice over internet protocol telephone service. That's what VoIP stands for.
It's our internet service for the district.
It's the phone service. The phone goes over the internet lines.
Do they service it if it breaks?
Yes.
BOCES does?
Yeah.
Okay. All the NARIC expenses, just review for us what the NARIC things are. Where is the NARIC? Entity.
It's NARIC is the Northeast Regional Information Center. They provide all the services for software, some of the programs that we use, managing our network. Mr. Bloomer is a NARIC employee who's based in our district. We have, you can see, we have some software that we use. There's the internet capacity. They do some things with assessment. They have equipment maintenance that we have through them. Our copiers are for them, are through them. They are responsible for our data warehouse. They are responsible for, we contract with them for our food service, for our student management system.
What's the installment purchase that's the biggest number in that?
The installment purchase, that's probably the copiers.
$106,000.
It's either copiers or what? I'll have Leah check on that though, because I don't have my BOCES stuff with me. So all things technology and communication related goes through NERIC. And again, as a school district, you always have a choice to go with an outside vendor, but as a small school district, if you do that, you lose the BOCES aid.
Just roughly, what's the percentage of this $343,000 some odd dollars that we might get counted for BOCES aid? 10% of it, 20% of it?
No, in the 70s to 80, 70 to 85. And I can't give you one solid number.
No, that's fine. I just want to have an idea.
Right. It's up there past 75 to 80%. And I'll tell you why. Because different services have different aid ratios. Because, of course, it would be nice
if
everything was
one. I remember going over that.
Right. Yeah. But that's not how it works.
And I have one more question on page 4.
Uh-huh.
PTEC.
Mm-hmm.
It says 11,500 of the students. Mm-hmm. Are we paying tuition for students to go to PTEC, or how is that working?
Well, first of all, the one number is wrong, just so you know.
Yeah,
they had an increase.
I think we had that many kids.
We don't. We don't. We actually have six. No, we have six. Or we'll have seven this year because we have some in the pipeline. So we only have seven.
Which category?
We have five.
Two categories.
Right. Well, we have five going to Ag PTEC next year. That's the new startup. And we'll have seven, not nine, at PTEC. So we only have one freshman going. That is the per student tuition rate. That is BOCES aidable. So what happens is the grant, you'll see this next year with the Ag PTEC, then the grant helps make the district whole. So the net cost to the district is zero. So we'll get BOCES aid on that student tuition. And then the grant fills to the 11.5. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
If I make sure you're listening.
We also get aid on a based on the number of students.
Right.
Do these students still count as Canada
Yes.
Air students?
Yes, they
so
do.
So we still get aid for the school district?
Yes. Yes.
Even though we get reimbursed for the tuition?
Correct. And it's no different than students that are at CTE for half a day or special education programs or the Adirondack Academy. They're still ours. We still always owe them. Their education is just in a different location.
Okay. So this will not take money out of our district?
No, not at all.
Okay.
Any further discussion?
Are there any other inaccurate pieces of data that you found?
No, that's the only one.
We're not approving a budget, we're just looking at a base budget.
Right, and Leah's reached out to BOCES. This contract was done, and they have had a lot of personnel turnover in their business office as well. That's now just getting settled. So she's been in contact with them to correct that one piece. We go over this multiple times, line by line by line by line.
Do we need to approve this to be entered into then?
It's the approval of the contract. Yeah, you have to approve the base contract.
The base contract. For now. No one's subject to change.
Do we need to make a friendly amendment to our motion that
pending the change
of the PTEC students, we would accept this budget?
Yeah, that's fine.
Yes.
They're going to help us fix it anyway.
Yes.
I would make that motion.
Yeah.
Second.
If you would accept it as a friendly amendment. I don't remember who made the motion originally.
I made the motion.
Okay.
I
accept
the motion. So.
Got that?
Mm-hmm.
Any further discussion on that? All in favor?
Aye.
Next, we have the annual school lunch program agreement renewal.
Move to approve.
Thank you.
I'm trying to.
This is our annual, the district's annual agreement with the federal school lunch program that allows us to get federal dollar reimbursement for breakfasts and lunches that are served here. The National School Lunch Program.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Next, we have school lunch bids.
Move to approve.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you. Discussion on this one?
Yep, so every year, the food service folks at BOCES, who we contract with for these things, go out to bid for the products that we need for lunches. And then Mrs. Dahlin Brody makes recommendations to us for the winning bids.
If the only question I had on this one, basis of our decision on who to choose, because I don't recall reading anything about that. Is it low price bid for the same item? What basis are we making that decision? That was the only question.
It is quality. It's a couple of different things. It is low price bid
because they were asking for specific items. This yes. ice cream novelty. So is
right.
it based on low price then?
Based on price. Yes. Also based on quality of
service,
and if they can, they do try to look at local vendors, but what starts it is the low price.
That was my question.
That's a good question. We did it one time. We asked for a complete breakdown, and she gave us about 15 pages worth of canned ham, 2 ounce, canned ham, 6 ounce, canned ham, 12 ounce, and pricing from this vendor. Okay, wait a minute. More than we really need to know. But you know, I think they're right in it, especially like under the frozen foods and such. They keep a number of companies kind of, she's probably monitoring prices regularly from these
yeah.
folks.
And it's always better to not be a sole vendor.
No sole
so vendors. So I was happy to see that.
Yeah.
That way you can
right.
negotiate.
Exactly, exactly. You know, when the price of products are changing constantly.
Right.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Next is the advanced therapy agreement.
Move to approve.
Second. Would you like to discuss what's up with this one?
So this is an agreement that we need to enter into for provision of speech and language services for a student in a specialized placement. It's part of the student's IEP. If the provider of the education piece doesn't have the related service personnel as part of their program, but yet it's on the student's IEP, then the district is required to find a provider.
And is it an in-district student, so it's not increasing our cost?
It is not an in-district student. It's a student in a specialized placement.
So wouldn't this be an additional cost to us then?
And
but
then
this is a district student.
Right, it's
that's
a district.
What I was asking.
Oh, I'm
yes,
sorry, you
this
mean
is
it's a resident.
A district student
yes.
that is
yes.
placed
yes.
outside.
I
want to
make sure we didn't have an outside person.
Yeah, no.
No.
No, I'm sorry, I didn't understand the question. Thank you for clarifying.
And the second question I had was, is this the same rate that we paid previously?
Yes. This contract is actually lower than it was last year because there was an additional service last year that was determined to no longer be necessary.
Okay.
So this is a lower price.
Those are the only questions.
Thank
you.
Is this aidable?
It's
stackable.
It's stackable.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, stack aid.
Yeah.
Stack aid.
I don't know. I next is the sharing agreement with the with Wheelerville. Can you say it? Wheelerville for a music teacher.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
Discussion on this one.
I have one discussion I had when I read this. And I'm sure we had the attorneys draw this up. My only question was, it says the employer-employee relationship is with us. And it says that in another section that we're, each school is responsible for defending if issues happen, etc. And hold the opposite harmless, which is appropriate. This is not personal. I'm just looking at it from a risk perspective.
Yeah.
If there was some issue that arose with him as us being the employer, even if it happened in their school, we would be on the hook for it, wouldn't we?
No, I think that's what that indemnification piece says.
But because we're the employer, if it's an employer suit, that was my question. It's
okay.
A very fine point.
That's a very, very fine point.
Yes.
Because
you understand what I mean?
Right, because if there was a problem in the other district, then the suit should go to the district and not the employer.
Yes. So that was my only question on this.
But that's a very...
Can we talk to Chris about
that? Yeah, we can follow up with Chris about that. That we own the position, that's what that piece means. You know,
I understand.
Yeah.
And it was clear, workers'
right.
comp and
all that
disability, all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But that, I could see, particularly a music student that's dealing with students, if there's some employer relationship claim that happens.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't see that clearly delineated. Because
mm-hmm.
yeah. it could happen in their district.
Right. Yep, I got what you're saying.
Okay, good clarification on that from the school attorney.
So, did you want to table that pending that?
Can we table that and he still starts in September? Because we won't meet again until after school starts.
No, I would be welcome to a friendly amendment that resolve, that issue is discussed and resolved with our attorney.
We can table it for now because we will meet one more time before school starts. Because there are going to be other...
We have some other personnel.
Personnel issues
okay.
that will have
personnel
to be settled before school starts
yes.
as well.
I mean, that's the better way.
Yes, that is
Which
the better way. So perfect, and he'll be able to
table.
He'll be just fine. So we'll just get that clarification. If there's any language we need to clarify, then we can do that and then approve the contract. So we're ready to go. Because Company of Song needs to get started right away in the body.
So we can take
mm-hmm.
the motion.
Yep.
Very good.
Okay. Until the very next meeting.
Next is the non-resident tuition policy.
Yeah, I was intrigued by the name.
Yes, non-resident student policy.
Non-resident student policy.
Tuition
is
a separate entity,
yeah.
Do you know how many times I read this over?
It probably sounded just fine.
It did.
Every single time.
It did.
Anyway, we need a motion to...
Yes, to agree adapt the policy.
I would make a motion.
Thank you.
The policy itself says on an annual basis the board will consider readapting it. Our June 2016 non-resident student count was 66, including employees' children. So our employees are here by contractual bargaining, right? So that's so it's probably 48 to 50 students. I would say they're non-resident.
And the other question I had on this policy, how, because I think it was left to you, if I remember reading this properly, to make sure that it's a student that we want here. that assessed annually?
Yes.
Okay. That's all I wanted to know.
Yep, yes and yes.
Not necessarily even annually, but halfway through the school year potentially. Whereas, you know, something should arise. Any further discussion on this? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained?
Next is the non-resident tuition rate. We need a motion to set that rate, right?
Right.
Motion.
To?
Zero.
Got that? All those words you just spoke?
Yes.
Discussion on that? So one of our jobs is to set tuition rate for the set non-resident students. And there was a time when we had tuition that was upwards of.
It was determined by the state.
Yeah.
I don't remember, it was fairly significant at one time.
It was, yeah.
We've since changed that.
So my only question is, because we get aid for them coming.
Correct.
Are we net zero on this?
Oh, because the, when we came up with a policy, the policy for zero tuition was that having that student here would incur no increase in cost to the district. So whatever additional aid we get for having the student is a net gain for the district.
It is.
Yes, it's a net gain for the district.
All right. That was my only question.
And if we think about how many students this encompasses, it's almost an entire grade level of the place that we have incoming students at the time. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Next is the 16-17 bus routes and drivers. Thank you.
Second.
Thank you.
There is no need for change this year.
Oh, he didn't change, okay.
The only question, comment, I guess, on this was I saw that the person in charge of the bus garage was running around. And I just remember from some of the personnel that we approved previously, is that balance from a cost perspective the way we're doing appropriate? I would think a bus driver would probably cost the district less than maybe some potential additions that we might add to staff. So that was my only thought around that when I saw that.
Yeah, Mr. Walker has driven a route as part of it for a while. The additional personnel at the bus garage this year will allow a mechanic to stay back on a rotating basis, so that if a bus has a problem, we don't have the mechanic out on the road. And not that Mr. Walker's not important, he's very important, but he recognizes that the need is for the someone to help if there's a problem.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Next is transportation contracts. There's two. We can do consent agenda. If you so chose, or we can do them individually. Perfectly fine. Come on, folks.
Consent agenda. We can do a consent agenda.
Second.
Discussion on?
So these are regular school year transportation contracts. One is with an agency, one is with a family. And the way transportation contracts work, you do the 10-month school year and then you do the 2-month summer program. So recently you approved at the last meeting the 2-month summer contract. These are the 10-month school year contracts.
My only question is, you know, the total annual cost for, say, for the first one, ground transportation, $48,000. Have we figured out that this is the most economic way to provide this transportation versus some form of district transportation?
I would say yes, because I know, Harold, what we do first is we look at, can we do this ourselves?
Yeah.
Without incurring significant additional cost, as in another driver, perhaps an aide on the bus, and some other
And to expand on that, having spoken with talked to them this week about a student, they have specialized buses that can meet specific needs of a student, like a specific wheelchair lift or something that a specific child needs. So instead of the district having to purchase that and whatever, they contract with Browns that already has that equipment, so it's cutting down costs there.
Next is the 2016-17 tax levy. I need a motion to set that levy at.
I'll make that motion.
You'll make that motion? To set the levy at?
0. Second.
Further discussion on that? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Next we have surplus items.
There's the remaining fitness center equipment that needs to be surplus. The computer tables are from the middle school lab, which is being updated this summer. So if you follow Mr. Rausch on Facebook, you will see that. And the high school desks and chairs are from the business classroom, which we updated last year. So Mr. May will take some of these to auction, and we've been pretty successful in the redesign of the fitness center with the old equipment, having it go for auction. Going that way.
Question, have we offered these publicly for prices we're asking for?
No, like we the board determined on Mr. May's recommendation to go through an auction house to do that. So that's where folks can. Sometimes local folks do go through the auction to.
So do we publicly notify people of that?
That they're in the auction?
That we are sending this stuff to auction.
Once the board surpluses it, there's a variety of things that could happen. So I don't know if we have to.
We do. Yes.
There.
I'll put it out of the paper, and I think Craig put
so
it
on. So we do need to do a public notice?
Yes.
Okay. That was my only question, because people in the district might be interested.
Might be interested,
right. Yes.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Okay, next we have the Capital Reserve Bus Replacement Reserve Fund. So we need a motion to use and replace.
replenishing it, why isn't it the same number?
This year, this past year, all of the buses went to lease, so this was the year that the price went up more than other years. So this was the bubble year, and then it'll start to go back down. But I'm going to have Mrs. Schaefer contact you with all the back detail on it.
Because we're spending more than we're transferring.
Pardon me?
We're spending more than we're transferring.
Right, right.
And that was not, it was confusing to me why it wouldn't be a wash.
Right. There's different leases. We went to all leases, but let me have Leah get back to you on that with some further detail. Actually, I'll get back to everybody on it.
Another question on that same thing is, why are we now authorizing payment for last year's leases?
Because we do with the, that's per the auditor.
Okay, that's the procedure we're supposed to follow.
Why authorize the reserve payment now? Yeah, for
if we could, that'd be great.
Yep.
Can we table this?
Probably. And if we're going to have a meeting in August, yeah, because these were the numbers the auditor gave Leah.
This is probably
I'm sorry, I didn't hear.
Another family that probably has moved into the district.
Yes, and Harold knew about this family. They are building a house, and they just finished the house, so now the transportation request has come in. It's on an already established route.
As a general rule, it's required
in April.
So we'll see a whole bunch of them in April.
I did see that it's going to move in, that's why they're late.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? Okay. Sure. So we're going to hold on that classroom issue for just a moment.
Okay. All right. So Ms. Damone will respond publicly to the questions, and as this is a synopsis of what was in the letter. The first question was around class size and class sizes. At the time when this information was shared, did not exceed 25 students at but we don't know that they'll stay that way because schedules are still being developed. But at the elementary level, we're within the contractual limit of 27 students per class. The plan from the building administrator is to evaluate and minimize class size at the K-2 level. And every year, Ms. Ward takes a look at the needs of the students, the numbers of students coming in, because we've seen a decrease in student numbers, although we've seen an increase in some need. So the number of classes and the at each grade level K-2 are determined based on the numbers in the cohort and the needs of the cohort. According to the school accountability report card that we looked at last month, our average class size is about 18. So that's that answer to class sizes. So as we have smaller numbers, there will be, I think, some fluctuation in looking at what are the needs of the students in any given grade level cohort, and how do we best establish what resources are needed for that. But at the elementary level, there's been a concerted effort to minimize class size at the K-2 level, at the earliest level. For the algebra classes, we had moved to a different model for providing support in algebra through a math lab structure. That got derailed a little bit last year due to the personnel issues that we had in algebra, which you may recall. The way Ms. Gleason and Mrs. Lenz have worked on this is that students with documented learning concerns are going to be assigned to a math lab as part of their schedule. And while other schools do offer a two-year algebra class, they do so for a small targeted group of students. Part of the challenge with our model is that we were using a two-year algebra class for remediation. And remediation should be supplemental instruction, not supplanted instruction. So in doing so, we were inadvertently creating a structural barrier for students to have access to higher level math classes. So it wasn't working for all students. And certainly there may be some students in the future that need a two-year algebra class, but we need to look at having more than one option for students. So if we're doing math instruction coming up K-8, as folks in K-8 have redesigned their math instruction in some really great ways, that students would come to high school algebra ready, if not having completed algebra in eighth grade. And this year, we had 50% of the entering eighth graders take algebra in eighth grade. So that's going to be another change. But the real reason for the model was we were using remediation. The only remediation we were offering students was a two-year class. Not all students needed that. So we're looking at moving to a different model. We've moved to a different model there. It just got a little crazy last year because of our personnel issues. The other piece along with that, we've talked about this before, the students who could take accelerated math and science at the middle school level was based on an arbitrary number. Like they just set a number at 25, couldn't go above, but it was always around 25. Rather than looking at what students may have the skill set and are ready to do that. So we've removed that artificial 25 number cap. And now the teams at the middle school look at the students and determine which students, based upon their skills, are ready to accelerate in math and science. And again, we had 50% of the entering ninth graders this year participate in algebra. So that's that piece. The project-based learning concerns, there were two clarifications that were needed. Our plan is to incorporate more project-based learning into the middle school experience, more being the operative word, not to do project-based learning all the time. We're not geared up or scaled up to do that. And in the information that Dr. Michelle shared, he is accurate to the degree that special education services look different for students at PTEC, but it does not eliminate services for students. Students with disabilities still have IEPs. We are still required, the district develops the IEPs, and we are still required to make sure that those IEPs are implemented. And here in district, there's not been any discussion at all about changing or modifying services for students with disabilities, period. And there's not been, again, our students with disabilities at PTEC have had IEPs, and their IEPs have been fully implemented. Our Smart Schools Bond Act and Investment Plan, we talked a little bit about that last time in presenting the plan. It's for reimbursable support for technology infrastructure and hardware. We used a very informal approach to find out, well, what do our folks say, our teachers and our students, the needs are for technology, and hands down, the number one response is we need more of it, more computers, more laptops, particularly more mobile technology.
So that's one piece of it. The other piece is really looking at technology within the district and reinstating our technology group, which we had, to help us come up with a formal plan, a more formal plan, and a clearer plan on how to use technology in the district. So the Smart Schools Bond Act and that investment plan is just for the hardware piece, and it's been pretty clear from everybody. The ongoing conversations with staff is that they want more additional access to mobile technology. Our Bassett Health program was just the contract for health services that Bassett provides the district. There was nothing anything different to that. Has no impact on district services except to enhance and support our school. The board authority policy, I believe, may be a reference to policy number 1120. There was some language that the board wanted to look at. So in the final policy, the language of the board that the board adopted reads, as a body created under education law of New York State, the Board of Education of the Canajoharie Central School District has full authority within the limitations of federal and state laws and the regulations of the Commissioner of Education and interpretations of them to carry out the will of the people. That was the original language that was maintained and added, and the educational mission of the district. And that was per feedback from all of you. The policy committee at that time took under advisement. The last issue was around electronic pay stubs, and we have addressed that personally with Ms. DeMille.
So it'll be published as part of the minutes.
Can it be? It's all right here.
Can I ask that it be added to the minutes?
Yeah, that might be kind of a normal process that we could just add some of this discussion to the minutes and then it's published.
Mm-hmm.
That's true. Sorry.
But it's okay. We can do both. There's no, it's right here.
Right. I mean, forget it's there, but
it's all there.
Next, class rank, policy 7223.
At the last meeting, you had asked for information about the courses that will be semestered as part of the senior year experience. So Ms. Gleason has provided that list and is here to answer any questions.
So there was no other change in the actual policy. It was just...
Correct. The question was, what are the classes that would be semestered?
Right. We'd ask to see that because none of us knew.
Right. I gave it to...
Yes, it's posted.
Yep.
So it's not on,
it's
it
on your
page.
Yep.
Yeah. Yes. Yep.
Go back to the...
Where is it?
If you go
back to
the
agenda.
Yeah.
And you get this item, if you go down to the bottom, it says executive content.
It's got a list of... Do you have it there?
Yeah,
yes.
I didn't see that.
So can you maybe
share
with
you guys?
Oh, there we go. There it is. So everybody else can see. If you have eyes there, that. Yeah, that's pretty good.
And so this list would incorporate just about everything seniors would be taking. And at the same time, the teachers that teach these classes are well aware of what they're...
I'm sorry.
Sorry.
It's little. I know it's little.
Right, that's
awful
small.
It's awful small.
Teachers are well aware of this list.
Am I able to ask one question? If somebody at FMCC takes an art class, will they get credit? And if somebody takes the art class here, will they not get credit?
Most of the art classes are only a half a year. Am I fair in saying that?
So you are in school year.
Typically, are incoming for most of the time. It's incoming freshmen, maybe 10th graders who take studio and art because it's the ticket into other art classes. It's not a typical art, a typical senior course.
Unless
but just in case it was,
art.
What are we doing about a situation like that?
We wouldn't do anything. It's an art class. So if they chose to take it as a senior and had never taken it before, then it would be calculated in the normal way that it's calculated. The kids who go to FM, we only transfer back the credits they need for graduation. So if a student...
That's not the way that is stated now, it says all.
It says what? I'm sorry.
It says that they're all...
I don't have the whole policy thing in front of me.
Says they're opposite of general courses, one credit.
All of them, opposite of general classes, all four, whatever they take.
So they're not weighted when they come back? Is that what the question is?
That's right, they just get seen as a general ed course.
Credit, I'm not talking about weighting, I'm talking about credit.
Okay, so if I go to FM and I take ceramics, or if I take ceramics here, it's going to be the same exact thing?
What if it's studio art?
I don't know that means studio.
Again, if studio and art, typically, if we're, I mean, we're not gonna semester... Right, and you have kids of all different levels in there.
That's a full year.
Right, and for some kids, it's every other day for a full year. So it wouldn't count during that senior year. No, it wouldn't be averaged in after the seventh semester.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
What would be the problem or the difficulty in just semesterizing everything? Just so that, because I'll tell you where I'm coming from. I really want to put this to sleep.
Listen,
I want this to be resolved. I don't want it to, I mean, obviously it could come up again at some point in the future.
Right.
But, you know, this thing, you know, I think if we could just semesterize everything, then it would just resolve that issue at least. And so we could just bury it and just have a policy that everyone would deem fair without any exceptions or, I mean, well, maybe someone could still come up with an exception somewhere, but, you know, any reasonable exception.
Well, I'm just going to say, then what you're saying is for all the ninth grade teachers, for all the 10th grade teachers, for all of the 11th grade teachers, in terms of when you semester a course, if you do it right, which means you take the first quarter twice, the second quarter twice, and you have a final exam, right? And that counts as a fifth of your grade. That's how you would calculate the semester. So I'm just saying that I think what I understand this notion of we want our work to count. I'm still hoping that our work counts all the time in what we do, not just because it's being calculated towards that seventh semester. I understand it, but now we're talking about trying to make for an exception for every rule. I can give you a case of a student this year as a senior who took studio and art because she had a moment and realized she wanted to study architecture. So as a senior, she took studio and art. That's the exception, not the rule. You know, so what we did, and in discussion with Dina and counselors from other schools and people at other institutions, some schools only semester those things that are the equivalent to what they would take at the college. So whether it's an AP course or a university in the high school or a college in the high school, those are the only things they semester. We didn't want to do that because we didn't want to say to all the seniors who aren't taking AP or honors or advanced courses that the work you do then in the first semester doesn't count. So what we tried to do was identify those courses most typically taken by juniors and seniors. Because, again, juniors in the sense that the third year of science, the third year of math, and for a lot of our seniors, they may not take the third year until their senior year, depending on the rest of their schedule, especially our BOTEC students. So we tried to find and accommodate for the majority of those classes that our seniors would be taking during the course of that year. And I think to say we're going to semester everything, then we might as well go to a full semester-based schedule. Well, and you can take studio and art for 80 minutes every day the first half of the year and then be done with studio and art and take a different elective second half of the year.
Well,
you know what I'm saying? I mean, it's just a total...
Yeah, but that's getting into course design, not averages.
Correct, but that's how most schools that semester, that's how they do it. If they move to the semester model, because they want to complete those grades in the semester, then that's what most schools in that situation, there are schools that choose to do that. I mean, even with courses like English, the juniors will take English for 80 minutes a day instead of 40 the first half of the year, and then in January take the Regents exam and be done with English for the year, if that makes sense.
Yeah, but you could also just take 40 minutes and have it in two semesters.
You can, but I'm just explaining to you that that means...
Extra exams.
It means how you're doing it, right. You can't just say, okay, this is what you got in the first two quarters, and I'm going to call that a semester average. That's not how you do it.
Because one of my other concerns is not only what exists now, which is that, you know, there might be a few possible exceptions, but even those I'm somewhat concerned about. But looking forward, when we're really looking at innovative courses, mm-hmm. and things like the global problem solving and others that I'm hoping that we'll come up with, you know, how are we going to design these so that all students can have access to them and yet still, because, you know, one of the whole things about, you know, the design of the situation was that we want to encourage people, you know, the credits that you get for you know, we get more
the waiting.
Thank you. The whole
design. Okay.
The waiting system and the whole design of this whole thing was to encourage our students to challenge themselves more. We could have a long philosophical discussion about whether you should challenge yourself for the sake of learning or for the sake of class rank, and I would be more than happy to argue against class rank as a motivator, but that's a whole other question.
Right.
It's there, and it certainly did accomplish what it was set out to do, which was to encourage students to challenge themselves more. And the thing that I'm concerned with now is that I think that we should try to resolve this in a way that will continue to encourage students to challenge themselves more. And if we end up with more innovative courses that are not semesterized, that they might not be taking them as much as we would like if they could see a way to kind of back off in their senior year, for example. So I'm just, you know, I understand the difficulties that you're raising in terms of, you know, more administrative, you know, things and so forth. But I'm just wondering if, in a way to resolve it and looking forward, especially to the more innovative courses that we're hoping to develop, and problem-based courses and all that kind of thing, if we could just come up with a way to just go full bore semesterization and resolve this issue once and for all. I'm just concerned. I don't want to...
But then I think that's a bigger conversation that you have to involve more of your staff in than just senior teachers, because that affects everyone. That affects all students, all teachers, that affects everyone. And we've been very focused on a very particular group of students and a very particular group of teachers. So I think it's a mistake to move so drastically in the other direction and not get feedback from other people. I think our goal was to make sure that the majority of things kids are taking their senior year are counting towards their seven semester GPA. Because six was too early, eight is too late. So we wanted to stick with the seven, and this was the happy medium of saying, can we make sure that the work students are doing during the first semester of their senior year counts towards their GPA. And so by semestering those leveled courses, we're making that happen. There are always going to be exceptions to the rule, and I agree with you, as we move forward and try to be innovative and creative and do different things for kids, we're gonna have to figure out as we move what that looks like in this system.
The example that you were using with this person that took art, that wants to be an architect, did you count that?
Well, it was a full year course, so the final average was not calculated until the course was over. And we don't use in-progress grades. The courses are calculated at the end.
So there was no exception.
So for all full year, but this current year, all full year courses were calculated at the end of the year. So that person didn't have it done any differently than any senior who took, for example, English 12. Okay. It was the same.
Because I thought you were expressing that you looked at what would have been done in college.
Well, what I have looked at transcripts and looked at the things people have transferred back, very typically, I mean, this year I think we had, and I can't remember, we've looked at the transcripts so many different times, I couldn't tell you who took what on what year. But the courses that were taken at FM, for example, were like ceramics, or some people took yoga to replace PE, things like as a PE elective. But, so student art wasn't something in the course of this year that we came across for somebody who was coming back, because it's not a typical offering at that level. The kids are going to be taking specific courses in specific areas, which we too offer, as Dr. Bow pointed out, which are already semesterized. Digital photography, ceramics, those kinds of things, drawing and painting, 1 and 2, those are already semestered courses. But again, there will always be an exception to the rule. We can come up with something for everything.
So for the group of students that are in that pool for class rank, which isn't everybody, so for that's really where the focus was, do these courses meet that group of students and what they would be doing their senior year?
I'm struggling with the filter we're putting on determining what that typical person looks like that this would apply to. And I think from what I just heard, this list then is only those AP typical kinds of classes, and not all of them that are semesterized, because you just gave a whole list that are not on what I'm reading.
Well, because the courses that are currently semesterized, I didn't include. They already exist as semester courses. The art classes, the elective art classes, and things like that I was talking about. They're already semesterized and have been. The ceramics and the things like that. Those were just an example of already semesterized courses. That had nothing to do with this. They just happened to be half-year course electives. So like health is a half-year course elective. Typically it's always been that way. So the courses that have always been semesterized, I did not include. I only included the things that we had discussed.
That were full-year courses.
That are currently full-year courses and have been. But again, we included English 12, because if you're including AP English, you may have students who are taking AP Bio and AP Calc, and that's sort of their thing, but they choose to take English 12 because maybe that's not where they feel their strength is. So we semestered anything that we thought was a senior level course in that regard to try and keep it fair for students.
So question, I apologize, I don't. How many potential electives that a student might take that are full year are we now putting in this other bucket over here? So if I'm a senior that decides that I want to take something different, and it's a full year course, so now it's not counting. I'm trying to figure this.
I'm not going to be able to give you a number, because
I
couldn't possibly do that without the program of studies in front of me. But I would say, again, I think of things like studio and art and DDP. And those are typically things that underclassmen take because they're like the entry into. You can't take any other art electives until you take studio and art. There are certain things in technology that if you're moving in that direction, you take DDP, and that also meets the studio art requirement for that 1 year of art or music that kids need for. So the typical electives I think of that are full year are typically our younger students. But again, I mean, we put applied physics on the list because a lot of juniors take it, but so do a lot of seniors who go to VOTEC in the PM. So we tried to take the things that we knew drew a lot of senior audience. And again, I think if we're going to go to a path where we think we should semesterize everything, that is a much bigger conversation, because I don't think I want to stand in front of the staff of teachers on opening day and say, FYI, you're now semestering everything. And so
that's
like a whole different.
Yeah.
Because we could have a student come in who moves in from a different state and ends up having to take things, right, Lucas, in a non-traditional way, because the state he moved in from didn't, you know, Captain Iowa had different things he had to take there. So we could have a student who comes in, and because they want that advanced Regents, is challenging things their junior and senior year that we never have kids take. There's going to be exceptions to every rule. Now, in those instances, you could choose to say, and I think I used the example of another time when we spoke about this, I've lost track, but like AP US, maybe we have a student move in their senior year and their high school did not offer AP US history. And they choose to take it despite the fact that maybe they've already gotten a credit for US and they took the regions, whatever. But maybe their school didn't offer AP. If that student moves in and takes the class, can we choose to offer that as a semestered option for that particular student? Sure. But I think to say we're just gonna semesterize everything on the chance that a senior is gonna take it, it takes us away from this thing we're talking about, which is class rank, and now we're talking about something very different. This is the list we came up with after we talked to other schools about the courses that they semester and what they do for seniors, and after we went through our program studies.
Right. But if I was considering taking like a major in colleges food science, we offer that course, and I know that Cornell has a major in it, but that's not on the list, so that wouldn't count my senior year.
Okay. That would be a good one to look at, because we do have a lot of seniors, you're right, who take that.
That's what I was trying to ask.
But that's not an elective. That's a course that many students take for their third science.
How about orchestra and band? Is that, maybe it's already semesterized, I just
It's not semestered, and it would stay the way it is now. Orchestra, band, choir, all of those things that kids have been doing from typically middle school through.
It doesn't count?
It does count. It's not being semesterized.
But it does count towards...
Well, for the first six, remember, you're taking that every year for 3 years, most often, and you're getting, that's calculated into your GPA with the credit every year for 3 years. But food science is a good catch. That's a good one that we should add to the list.
Curious.
Yeah.
Also with the goal of problem solving, like if I'm saying, like I know that you guys do the half year or the every other day.
Yeah.
Like that.
Right.
But full year, people that take the full year, yes, but that also...
You mean like every day for the full
year?
Well, then I just think in that area, then it's hard, because then you're some kids who can only fit it in their schedule every other day. You know, they're all doing so much work, I don't know that you want to say some kids get it and some kids don't. And if you semesterize the quarter credit, well now, you know what I mean, then it just...
I mean, at least they're still getting a quarter credit.
Right.
And the people that go there every day, they're still getting the half credit. So, I mean, it's the amount of work they put in.
Right. And I just think at some point we sort of have to find a place to like draw the line, or again, we're going to semester everything.
Just because I know, like, I don't know if I'm interested in any of those sciences. Like when I go to college, because I don't think I'm going to need AP bio, because I'm not going to be able to go. So I didn't know.
Oh, and is geology on the list? Because geology wasn't a core. Did I put it on? You know I can't read that, right?
It's on.
I have to borrow her glasses. Because that one was, it was in the program of studies, but we haven't run it in a while, but we have two sections of it this year. We have over 30 students taking that, so. Yeah. Yeah, Mr. Perry's excited.
In the same way that you talked about a student coming in from elsewhere, could we semesterize things if seniors are taking them? But not for the entire school.
Yes.
You know, as well, you're talking about for the...
I don't think it's a blanket thing you say. I think if we're going to think about that, like the example I gave, then it's a student-by-student situation. Because I don't think it's just a blanket. So everything a senior takes, no matter what they're doing, if it's something they took... You know what I mean? We're going to semester all those things, and then you have multi-grade classrooms. I just think you have to be careful with just sort of throwing that out into the universe. But that's, I mean,
I understand what you're saying, but on the other hand, I really, really want to resolve this.
And I do too, but again, I'm going to go back to, I feel like, and listen, I want kids to to feel like they're getting out of it what they put in. So I'm working hard and therefore this grade counts towards my GPA. I get all that. The truth is, when it comes down to something that's going to be valued at like a quarter credit, the minuteness of what that will do to a GPA that has been calculated over 7 semesters, you know, if we're going to get to the math of it, is that why we're doing it now? Or is there some other reason that we feel the need to do it? Because, you know what I'm saying?
So you're feeling, I'm sorry.
I feel like students are taking those classes because they also want to and because Agreed. They need it for college. But it's also not just the recognition or whatever, it's also the scholarships that are tied to the numbers they are with the class, right? Because I know the first 12 get the RCAL scholarship, right?
There's RCAL, 10. She said, I don't know the
no,
numbers.
No, there's 10.
Oh.
And two Richards.
Oh.
So there, yeah, but you're first thinking, 12, right, yeah. The first 12 are the larger scholarships,
some
you're right.
Some of those kids actually need that scholarship. Like that's, and I'm not saying that's all that they're going for is the money, but I'm just saying.
Right, and I don't disagree with you at all, but what I'm saying is, just like your GPA when you get to college, that first semester, everything you do counts, especially if you have to keep an average for a scholarship. So let's say you go to school and you have to keep a 3.6 so that they'll keep paying your full tuition. Everything you do that first semester is like life or death, because that 3.6, everything. Now by the time you're first semester senior year, that B doesn't carry as much weight, and it's not going to pull that course average, it's not going to pull your cumulative average down because you get one B. So my point is, at some point we have to decide what is our goal and why are we doing it. So our goal was to make sure that our students felt like the majority of the work they're doing during the course of their senior year counts towards their class rank, which I understand because they're working hard. But then if we're going to get into every quarter credit of everything that a senior could possibly be sitting in to take, then I guess my question is, why are we doing that?
I think that's a point of fairness and equity.
And I also think we can't lose sight that there are freshman, sophomore, and junior year's worth of work that also contribute to class rank. It isn't just the senior year. There's a history between freshmen, it's 7 semesters. So I think we have to remember that too, that it's not just one year or one set of courses. There's a cumulative effect to the work that students do. Students come in freshman year working hard and just keep going.
I'm sorry,
would
I just speak to that? Because we had an example this year with actual data for students and their averages and their credits, and we had a student who took less courses move ahead of somebody who took more courses that were more difficult. So it did not fit the mission of that class ranking, taking more difficult classes and more classes. Because the student who took half year classes got credit, the student who took full year classes did not get credit, and the person who took the half year moved ahead 4 spaces. Two spaces ahead of students with 4 AP classes. So,
well, but
hand somebody a half of a credit, that's a huge difference. It's a huge difference for one person to get a half a credit and another person to not get a half a credit.
Right, but that won't be happening anymore.
Yeah, but I mean,
because this course
we're dealing with AP
semester.
Courses that were year long courses that are now semesterized.
Right.
So
we've
that.
Already addressed it.
And the truth is, I'm going to go back and say. And I would go back to say, too, those classes have been set up as semester classes and semester electives for a long time. And we, when...
That's not how our classroom was done for years.
That is definitely how it was done for the last 3, because it's in-school tool.
I agree, that might be the case.
Right. So I can't speak to what happened prior to the existence of school tool.
I think if we're encouraging students to pursue... ought to be some aspect of fairness and equity, no matter what classes they take, that it's being measured similarly for all students for their ranking. And I think that's what Mark's trying to get at.
No, I get that. And I think that's what we have been trying to do in coming up with the list of courses we would semesterize, so that it would create a more level ground for those students who challenge themselves with full year advanced courses. But I'm also gonna say, I applaud the student who followed her passion and took the classes that sparked her and inspired her, instead of worrying about, this is what everybody else thinks I should be taking. So I just don't want us to go, you know, this isn't just for the top 10 kids. This is for all of my kids. So I don't want it to be so much so that this is all about, let's make sure those kids who take the, because I want kids to follow their passion too. I want kids to take those classes they want to take. So I get it. Now we're saying that everything counts. And I get it. It does. To a certain extent, it absolutely does. Especially if you're talking about, you know, somebody who takes 5 or 6 half-year courses and somebody else who took all full-year courses. But I thought the point of semestering these things was to create a more level playing field where that was concerned.
But
now we're talking about something else, then I guess we'll have to go back and look at what that means.
I think this list puts together a more level playing field of looking at the students that are in APs. I don't think it necessarily is fair and equitable to students that are choosing something else.
But it includes English 12, it includes applied physics, which is not, those are not courses that are typically, it includes financial math, it includes things that are not typical, right? Financial math is like the typical third or fourth math for students who are not necessarily the ones who I talked about earlier taking geometry and algebra 2 and those kinds of courses. So we did semester all the full year options that apply to seniors, but then we took those fringe things that, again, those third year math and science classes, so those kids who are seniors are trying to get their third credit of math or third credit of science are still getting that first semester averaged in.
See, let me just expand a little bit further. I mean, frankly, I mean, if you want to get into discussion, especially class rank, I think that is a motivation. I reject it, but that's a whole other discussion. I'm trying to deal with the question that, you know, of the level playing field that we're all talking about. So I would just love to see class rank abolished, period. But that's not the policy that we're discussing right now. But the thing that I have a concern with is, for example, let's say we come up with some innovative courses. And, or some externships, or things of that nature, you know, that it would not necessarily be the kids who are, you know, the AP takers, let's say.
Right. Which I get, which the courses in front of you are not all the AP takers. They're
no,
all
but,
the
but
same.
But I'm saying, I'm trying to look forward and say, is there a way that we can reward those students equally with the AP who are taking these other innovative options? You know, like the kind of thing that Scott was referring to. You know,
But then as we create those things and they become new to our system, then we have to figure out how they fit the system. Because that's going to be true with whatever we do. You know, if we're trying to do the 7 semesters, the other option we can go back to is do it after 6 semesters. Because then you know everything you have taken in the first 3 years counts towards your GPA. Because if we're going to get into every single thing that could be a quarter credit or could be a this or, you know, a senior might end up taking DDP or a senior might end up taking Global 10 or a senior might end up taking, you know, because kids who repeat. We have kids who double up and take English 11 and English 12 their senior year because they didn't do so well the first time around. So should we semesterize English 11 so that, so, I mean, maybe the answer is instead of worrying about semestering everything, we go back and we do the 6 semesters.
You know, but again, that kind of goes against what the whole weighting system and so forth was developed for, was to have helped encourage kids to challenge themselves in a senior year.
Mm-hmm. But I'm also going to say, when the college gets...
I think it's overall. I don't see it as just challenging them in the senior year. I think that's developed as a function of where those classes sit in the schedule. And the seniors last year were very clear about that, that they, their recommendation is we consider how to spread those out more so that they're not all stacked. That, it never says anywhere in the policy that this is about senior year classes. It talks about challenging you during your seven semesters of your high school experience. The other piece of how it's played out is played out just by a function of how schedules and courses have been offered. It's not what the policy says. The policy talks about seven semesters.
You can take AP Bio in 10th grade if you so chose. To take it as a senior. You take biology first, but you take that as a freshman. And AP Bio is a sophomore. Math has to go in order. Physics doesn't have to go in order. Neither does chemistry.
There has to be a table of things, doesn't there? There has to be some science sequence.
Right. Not necessarily.
Right.
Yeah, there is.
Yeah,
yeah, but you don't have to, you're right, you don't have to take it your senior year.
You don't have to take your senior year.
You don't have to take your senior year. And thanks to this whole debate, many of our friends are not. We have a large number of juniors who have requested it.
That's been positive. So I don't want us to lose sight of the fact that this is about seven semesters. So I know it's like this particular group of classes, but the policy is bigger than that. The policy is bigger than senior year. And it's program. It's about what kids choose to do from their freshman year on so that they're having the best high school experience that they can for their future.
What would be interesting, if we could have our magic globe, right, would be if you made it six semesters, what would happen to AP enrollment for the senior year, the way we have courses?
I would hope that students would just keep right on going because that's what they should
and
be.
And I'm
going
to say not only hope, but our kids that are competing for this rank are the same kids who are competing against thousands upon thousands upon thousands of kids to get into good colleges. And what is the expectation of a college who is making that decision about acceptance? They're looking for strength of schedule and they're looking for what did you do? Yes, I mean... Because some schools do class rank after six and report it out at the time when many kids are doing their applications. Other schools do not. Some schools never do class rank. So all of that stuff sort of gets lost in the mix as opposed to what the school itself looks at. And they have their own formulas, colleges, to calculate, to weight things and look at things and determine how they believe you stack up against people from schools who do it very differently or states who do it very differently. And they look a lot at strength of schedule. So if your senior year, let's say you were number one in your class at the end of six semesters, and then your senior year you're not taking the courses that best challenge the level you appear to be at, then you're not getting into that top college. So, you know, could kids do that? Sure. But then they're not getting into that top choice school. They're not getting into those number one schools because those schools aren't taking you unless you have strength of schedule for 4 years and can show that work for 4 years. And schools, we send a final transcript. So at any point, a school can say, most will say you're conditionally accepted upon completion of, and graduating for all of those schools doesn't mean successful completion. They reserve the right to say you did not live up to your end of the bargain. So I think for the kids that are competing for those top 10 spots, which now as our class enrollment shrinks is not, you know, is way more than 10% of the class, those kids want to get into those top schools. At least their top choice. And it is more competitive now than ever. So you better have a good strength of schedule and a good performance your senior year, or you're not getting in.
I guess we're all coming to at this point based on our discussion is that this seems to address the lion's share of the issue that we've been dealing with over the last number of months. I would be prepared to, I hope, just speak for myself, to adopt the new class rank policy tonight with the understanding that these regulations, you know, with the semesterizing would be implemented, you know, as you know, you've listed. I think, though, what I would like to see is in our October meeting that we kind of get a summary of where things stand with our seniors, to see if there are issues or problems that might be, you know, like see where we're at and see what the issues might be, with the understanding that we might reconsider the regulations in terms of this at that time, and with possible revisions suggested, but that at least provisionally at this point, that we would go forward with what has been presented, my feeling at this point.
I'm not there.
And just as a note, the policy committee at the time had suggested that whatever decision the board makes, that it's reviewed in a year. Because there are going to be some other factors that are coming up, entering freshman class of 58 kids. Like, I think this is going, there's going to be some things about this innovative classes, some other things that we have to, that will impact this policy as it currently operates. Or could operate.
What's the downside of just going to six semesters?
I think my concern would be that we haven't had enough time with students to really do the job we should have been doing and are doing now with program planning to push students to make sure that they understand that the reason why they're taking these classes is because they should and because it helps them towards their future goals beyond just this is part of class rank.
You mean for the seniors now?
Yeah, for the current students.
For people that are freshmen are right on some track for some purpose, right?
I mean, right, and they're gonna have the benefit of the one-to-one program planning with Mrs. Lenz that until this past year really hadn't happened for a little while. So I worry less about them because I think they will be pushed every year in their program planning.
If I think in our district this is complicated because we do give money away. You know, as a public school district, at least all the people I know, very few schools give away the kind of money that we do as scholarships. And that complicates this. It makes it a different thing, and you really have to be looking at the fairness and equity of it in a way that no one's going to be able to say, well, I got cheated.
I don't know that we...
I'm not saying we did, I'm just saying...
No, but I'm not saying we can say that under the current policy it was fair and equitable either.
I agree.
I don't think it was either. I think it absolutely helped some students do really, really great things. I'm not sure that it's in a place where all students are doing the things they should for their own greatness, whatever that means.
I agree, which is, I'm back to Mark's original point.
Yeah.
How do we solve this? I don't like doing things halfway.
Or in multiple, or in steps or in phases.
It feels like we're not fixing this.
I would just remind people that, again, I do not know what happened before the invention of School Tool. But for the 3 years prior to this, that's how it was done in the system. So then, now it's unfair. So I'm sorry, what?
I'm sorry, School Tool was here 400 years ago, and it was done correctly then. They used in-progress grades.
Okay.
In-progress grades, so everybody at half semester, every credit count.
All right, so then maybe it's just since someone stopped doing it by hand, which is what happened with prior, since School Tool has been the source of calculating it. I guess I should say it that way.
That's the information we have.
Since SchoolTool has been the source of calculating it. Prior to that, it was done by hand, and I can't speak to what happened, because I come from a place where we would never use in-progress grades. So, I don't know how that was done, but it was calculated by hand. Since it's been calculated in SchoolTool, this is how it was done.
SchoolTool was in progress for 2 years before the 3 years you're talking about.
All right, but SchoolTool did, it was done by hand though. Because we have the paperwork, it was done by hand. So I get it.
Right.
But for the last two then at least, or the last three if we count the one that just happened, it was done in SchoolTool, did not use in progress, it was done exactly the same way it was done this year.
So if at some point we did it that way, we didn't go to this whole semesterized testing, and I understand all of what you're saying there, but we just took an in-progress grade. By the way, I do see the pros and cons of that. That is something that you could still do. You don't have.
You haven't earned anything with an in-progress grade. That's the reason to semester, is so you can say, I have earned this half credit, and this is how much it's worth.
But that's only because we have it worded that way. We can change that.
But you haven't earned a credit to take a grade for. So, I mean, pick anything that could happen. I get mono. I don't know, anything that could happen. You have an in-progress grade, which means every time I put a grade in, every time I say you got 5 out of 5 for doing that right, or every time you turn in a paper and I give you a check and I say I count that as 10 out of 10 or whatever, that adjusts your grade and modifies your grade. But you haven't earned the credit yet. In order to earn the credit, you have to have a grade and finalize it.
I understand, but it's our policy that's making it say it's an earned credit. We could change the policy to say it's an in-progress grade. So
then what if a student after 7 semesters says I'm going to drop that course because now my average is done and I'm ranked whatever and I'm going to drop because I didn't finish it, I didn't earn a credit for it, but I got that grade averaged in, so now I'm going to drop that course.
Yep, that's the downside of that particular option. There's downsides on every option that I've heard so far.
But he didn't. You don't earn the half credit until you finalize the grade and earn it. You're in progress of earning it, but you don't earn it until you finish it and complete it, whether that's a half or the full. So.
Well, but hopefully with individualized counseling, as we are now doing.
Correct, right.
Students will understand if they drop the course after they're in progress grade, that the college might reconsider their
admission.
You're
absolutely right, that's true.
As happened to Jake, for example, my son, because for some reason his transcript was not sent to where it needed to be, he just got a letter that if you don't get it by such and such a day,
right,
you are not in this school anymore. And, you know,
they absolutely,
it's not a final admission
happen.
Decision, you know, I mean, it's a conditional admission.
Right.
Can I ask an administrative question? Is it able to, I understand we're using a system now to do this, is that system able to be, does it have an appropriate parameters to use an in-progress grade?
I don't know.
Well, I know that Dina runs it. I can't remember what it's called, but she runs the whatever in the system to make sure it's all situated,
okay,
and then it pulls. Again, I think prior to it was done by hand.
So the best we've been able to uncover, that's the...
We think it could.
Yeah.
I'm going back to, before we do that, do 6 semesters. Because I just think that's...
far with senior schedules. How many seniors are taking a full
You know what, I'd have to go, that's a good question, and I could pull the course list and do it by the seniors and see how many kids are taking each thing. Off the top of my head, I don't have that. But like all of our VOTEC students, if you're a senior VOTEC student, we don't get their final average till the end. And that's the way VOTEC calculates their grades. So for them, that we don't have a system by which to calculate it, because we don't get grades for them until the end.
See, from an aspect of in-progress grades, that's a fair and equitable thing. From a semesterization perspective of a true course grade, it's not necessarily fair, because you haven't really had any testing to say that's right. What you've earned, etc. Right. So there's still both sides to that, but that seems more inclusive in terms of people that are in different curriculums, different, you know. I think there's more to this than just...
Well, what would you folks like to do after this discussion?
I agree it's not fixed.
Okay.
What we haven't done is we've been trying to work just with the policy as it stood. We haven't branched out to say, here are other options, including one which is to abolish the policy. Here is an option B, C, D, and I'm not saying that. I'm just saying we are looking at trying to do one thing
right.
Rather than what might be four or five different possibilities. That's a big number, but there are, what are the range of possibilities?
And obviously, to have my mind around this, I started creating that list from our discussion. You know, and I think everything I've heard has pros and cons.
Right.
So I think at some point we have to decide which pros are most important and which cons can we, you know, live with.
The question becomes, are you interested in doing the work of expanding the range of options?
Personally, yes.
Well, it's really the policy committee.
which I'm on.
Yeah. Yes, would you?
Personally, yes, because I think the majority of us have expressed in one way or another.
I'm sorry, I have to step out for a minute.
That we're not satisfied. That we feel there's a shortcoming.
It needs to be. This is it, and there's not a variance, and just how things are graded, how it's framed, weighted. Weighted is what I mean.
That is a possibility.
Yeah.
Until kids can start saying, I'm going to school because I want to learn, I don't think anyone took global problem solving and said, oh my God, it didn't count. They loved it. They had a great experience with it, and other kids wanted to take it more, unable to. But until every class is that, here we are.
Again, I go back to, I think this is about this is about a student's educational experience in the whole. And I think I've been concerned that we've kind of lost that and we're focusing only on certain things, but this is about from the time you enter as a freshman until whatever point in time.
They're not thinking about it then.
Well, I know, but they should be.
They should
and
be.
And I'm going to say some are. Not certainly not
but
everybody.
But they're really thinking about it for senior year.
Yes, but again, it's the whole experience. It's not just senior year and senior year classes. It's what have you done up until that point.
Well, I think we really need to look at more options. And included in those, looking at those options, would be abolishing class ranking. And look at other schools that have done that, and and see if there's some way that we can have a resolution that would, you know, not leave any gray areas. Maybe there is none, but if we can come up with one, to me that would be the solution I would love to go for. And it may be one that will require more discussion with our community and so forth. But I really think that, you know, this is not resolved.
It's not sitting with folks.
Can I ask a practical question? Because I'm not sure of the answer. Where does this sit for, if we don't act on this, it reverts back to the policy that was in effect?
There already is a policy in effect, so
which was only credits earned.
So that's what the policy says.
So none of the AP courses would count. That's the way it sits now, and that's what would happen. It would revert back to that.
Because that piece of the language of the policy has been in existence since the policy was created.
But we could, as an interim thing, while we're reconsidering this, which probably would not happen prior to, you know, resolve prior to the beginning of the next semester.
Oh, I would hope so.
You think we'll get this resolved by September?
Oh, no, I thought you meant like January.
What I'm thinking is that since Ms. Gleason has already done the work of semesterizing, you know, this amount of courses.
We haven't. Didn't know what would happen. We have a list, and Mrs. Lenz and I will do it. But we didn't do anything because it's a lot of work to go through, and you have to change the courses in the course catalog. You have to change everything. So we built it in the system using full year, just because that means too, like, kids would get the full year of AP Bio. We didn't risk something jumping off and whatever. So kids are in their classes right now, full year in their classes. Our intention was to take the list, go back, change the course catalog to match what we're saying, because in the course catalog you have to set up the weights and all the pieces, and then we'd have to move the kids to the semester courses out of the full year courses, which we're happy to do, but we didn't until we knew there was an answer.
Well, I guess what I'm asking is this a tremendous amount of work to be done? Could it be done reasonably for this incoming semester?
It can be done, yes.
Would it cause us not to be able to do other things that need to happen?
Well, there's a lot to do. It's at that time of year, there's a lot to do. We've been hanging on, waiting to know what step we're going to take. If this is the step we're going, then we'll semester them. If it's not the step we're going, then we're not going to go through all that work just for the sake of doing it. So if you, as a group, decide this is the way we're going and we're going to semester courses, then we'll...
If we semesterize courses, regardless of what we decide about class ranking, is there any downside to doing that from your perspective as an administrator?
No. It's what the senior teachers and I talked about when all of this topic kind of first came up, and we met and we talked about semesterizing courses and how that would help to try and make things more fair.
And so everyone's on board with that in terms of this list?
Well, they were on board with the idea of semesterizing the senior courses so that we could... No, we just talked about semesterizing senior courses.
But the staff was on board with doing that, provisionally.
Yes. With semesterizing courses, yes.
So, and in semesterizing the courses, does that mean each one of these courses that winds up getting semesterized, you're going to put a end of semester final in place or end of semester?
There will have to be some. There will have to be some type of assessment at the end for that 20%. You don't always have to give a pen and paper final, right? You can So whatever their choices of, but we have already discussed doing a modified schedule the week of Regents Week, so So all the kids would still come in, but they would see, they would have 2 hour blocks of time with their teacher over the course of those Regents days, so that people who are doing semestered courses could have final presentations or final exams or practice APs or whatever they want to use that 2 hours for. Every student would see each of their teachers for a 2 hour time span during that time. So then people would have time to close out their semester courses. Because it is different too. It's not like you're just putting in your second quarter grade and there I go, my grades are done. Because now you have to put in your, make sure your second quarter grades are done, and then put in some kind of an assessment, and now you have a final average for those courses, and you know, it's just more legwork, so to speak. But doing the modified schedule during the Regents week gives us access to the kids to do real midterms, real finals, real presentation, all that kind of stuff. And it gives teachers time to close out that semester and get ready to start the next one.
If you did the in progress grade, would you have to change anything in the system then?
So we need to make a decision.
If it's already a full year class?
That isn't in line with what the policy says, which says it has to be an earned credit. Right, but we won't know that probably before. For you guys, anyway, we have to. But, yeah, you're right. Because we had talked about there were just a lot of things you guys didn't really know that you just weren't aware of. Which I think that's something that Mrs. Lang is working on.
No, because the teachers would want to know why. Because we need to plan their, because you have to plan the semester activity.
Sounds like people had this. The easiest thing to do would be to take an in progress grade.
Well, maybe you guys should talk to the other kids about taking
it.
That's
the easiest.
They don't have any of the administrative
work. This year, we had to get rid of.
That's the easiest thing to do. It still accomplishes what you're trying to do. These people all get a grade.
But you feel, like you said, you feel better about it, and that's going to make you a better driver.
Yeah,
for
sure. That is,
but yeah, then
again,
you
that
guys
is
should
one
talk
awesome.
Like this
that
year
is
now,
one option. That is an option. I
listen,
think the challenge is
you're thinking
it's
about
not
you're going to be a driver.
Is what our
take
policy,
this
with what the
because I agree with you. I think it's.
I know that's not what this is.
Yeah,
right.
I think it's
so
a
you
very
would,
valuable experience.
The board would need to make a decision about that piece of the policy.
Personally, I think that we should explore other alternatives, but we need to fix this for what's going to happen now. And exploring the other alternatives doesn't seem like it should put a burden on the administrative process and shouldn't redefine the system until we really know what the heck we're doing. So that's why I'm saying that might be step that doesn't cause any undue harm or work there, and we put ourselves on a calendar that says, okay, let's flesh out what all these options are, and let's get this nailed down in a way that we're more comfortable we're solving the problem. That would be my recommendation.
Then you would be amending the policy. So, I just want to make sure
understand.
We're right, that would be changing the policy. Because the other option, again, just of all the options, you just let the policy run as is for right now. I'm not saying that's
true.
That's just another option.
That is absolutely true. That's the other thing.
So you would basically say earned credit or interim?
You would just say in progress grades or earned credit, right?
Well, I think that's too confusing.
Yeah.
That's because that's two different things.
Can I just say something?
I mean,
word.
But I think we have to be clear, an in-progress grade is not the same thing as earned credit.
No.
They're not even close. So we need to, if any language change like that would need to be precise, or we're just going to muddy the waters more than I think they already are in terms of our conceptual understanding, our knowledge base around some of this stuff. So I think that would be too mucky for a day.
Becky? My suggestion would be, because I talked to the juniors last year when all of this was going on, and it's nerve-wracking for them, and it is unfair for them to start school and not sort of have some notion that I can say to them, this is how it's going to be. So I would suggest, while you're finalizing this and thinking about the different options or what else could be done, we just semesterize the things we know that the kids are taking. The things on this list are the things kids are taking. I can absolutely go back and I can pull a list of every single course a senior is taking.
I think you have.
And we can look at that and say, did I miss a gap somewhere? I'm gonna take Carolyn's thing and add food science, because we do have a number of seniors who take that. So can we just do that so that these juniors who are coming in now as seniors, they're 3.5 weeks away from their senior year, we can say to them, we are semesterizing these courses. And then as the rest of it shakes out and we figure things out, maybe that will also help us see how this works in action, so to speak.
I'm fine with that, with the caveat you added of looking at what seniors are in. That was off the table before. It was, no, we're not going to do every course.
Well, I mean, I still think that for the most part, you have to stick with what would be senior level courses, or we'll be doing it for everything anyway, which is what we already talked about, sort of changes the world. But I think this will get us to most of the students that we have had, that have had concerns. And there are going to be exceptions to every rule, because that's just the world of education, sadly. But there's going to be things that come up. I'm saying we might, as Carolyn pointed out, the idea of food science, there might be something that pops up like, oh my God, I wasn't thinking about X. 15 kids are taking this, but.
I'm okay with that, but I want to see that list.
Well, but
because that's the only way fairness happens, in my opinion.
We
can
amend it if needed. Policy doesn't change.
At this point, though,
right.
This list
then you
changes.
Amend this list, and we have more
list.
Courses that are semesterized.
So at this point, would everyone be comfortable with going forward with approving this class rank policy, with the understanding that this would be the regulations that would go with it, which is semesterization of this list, and that we can always reconsider it once we get the list of all the other courses. So that at least the incoming seniors will have some basis to.
I don't want it to be, though, that we might alter things. I think we need the list, and we need to make sure that all the seniors are being treated the same. That we haven't just unilaterally picked out the AP classes or this class.
Certainly amend that at any time. You could amend it in September. Put this.
We have to have a place to start, because we have 3 weeks before school starts.
Exactly.
So I would ask that list is delivered to us at our next meeting.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
I don't know when that is.
Well, we haven't said it yet.
Oh.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it'll be sometime.
It's at 11 o'clock.
it'll be before school starts.
We can certainly adopt the policy as written. This becomes part of the regulation piece. Not really part of the policy at all. It's part of the regulation,
which we can amend at any time.
Policy stands as written. If that's what you want to do.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Absolutely.
And we can amend that at any time.
I'm okay with that, as long as the discussion that I really felt was going on isn't what's happening. So I want to see the list, and I want us to then be able to revisit that and say, okay, these four classes aren't on there, and they should be.
And we adjusted accordingly.
Okay, so clarification, am I just making a new list? Or am I doing the things that are on this list and then looking at the current senior courses? Which way is that going?
What I'm asking for is that we see all the senior courses, and we're agreeing that this that's where we are right now. I'm understanding this correctly. And I'm okay with that.
And then we can discuss those and discuss whether or not they need to be addressed as well.
And we discuss those other courses, correct?
And we may decide that they need to be addressed or not.
Correct.
The number of students, seniors in those courses.
Right.
In what courses? The ones we have?
Just all this, with all the courses, the list of the courses.
Okay, so I'm not just looking for places where there's multiple seniors in a given spot. You want to know every single thing a senior is taking.
What the senior list of courses are and the number of students. Right, currently scheduled for those.
Yes.
Is that something School Tool could pull for us, do you?
I don't know if it works that way.
Okay.
If it'll just produce, like, I don't know. Dina will have to help me with that one.
Yeah, okay. Or your friend.
Or Deirdre.
Deirdre, your friend.
My best friend at School Tool Narrative.
Our best friend at School Tool. We love Deirdre.
I call her a lot.
We don't have to, you can do something with the policy or not, because what we're talking about really are regulations.
Regulations, exactly.
So, I know you don't want to hear the word table one more time, neither do I. But I just want to remind you that is an option. Because the current policy would hold, what we're talking about is the regulation procedural piece.
Well, the policy as stated would take all the semester, all the courses on the semesterized list and make them earn credits. And we would have a list delivered to us of the courses that seniors are in that are not on that list and would be able to make
That's the regulation piece.
But that's regulation. That's not
policy. That's not the policy.
Yeah, we're not looking for a list of all the seniors in all the courses. We're just looking for seniors in courses that are not on this list.
I gotcha.
But the policy part is, if we adopt the policy, it's earned credits. So everything on the semesterized list falls under the policy.
That's right. Yeah, that's not really a change in the policy. That's been the same. We just tried to clarify the language because Carnegie credits was confusing to people.
And also the earned credits thing, especially in terms of FM.
Right, right. The FM pieces were new.
The waiting.
The waiting, yeah. That
right.
We cleaned up.
Yep.
Well,
that's fine.
So this has been moved and seconded, right? Before we even discussed it or not.
No.
No, this
no.
is under old business. We haven't moved or seconded.
I'd like to make a motion that we adopt the new class rank policy with the understanding that the regulations would include semesterization of the current list and our seeing a list of all students in other courses, seniors in other courses not on the semester.
So sorry.
Can we really move it quickly?
Because there's three things to click on.
They're all very short, though.
They are short.
Mm-hmm. How about we go over the update?
Oh, God.
Not the letters, but the update.
We love that.
Can we do that?
Yes.
Okay.
So the next, well, so following Mr. Hill's presentation at the last board meeting, Ms. Gleason and Ms. Barkas put together a document, and I'm going to ask Ms. Gleason to review some of the pieces about
the document that we believe answered the questions and concerns.
Sorry,
this is what happens, Ms. Gleason, when you know aren't here for a meeting. We just give you everything the next meeting.
That's fine. What am I reviewing? Do you want me to just go through our bullet points?
Yes, please.
Good thing I brought it. So in April, the officers had a class meeting. They referenced it by saying this was the same time, around the same time as the Krispy Kreme fundraiser, because they were doing both of those things. At the meeting, students were presented with this specific venue and the idea of having the prom off-site. So the vote was on yes to being off-site and yes to being at this venue. At that particular meeting, no one expressed its concern about the location, and everyone was in agreement that they wanted to have the prom somewhere else, and the Water's Edge Lighthouse was that choice. That was prior to learning that they were only available on Fridays, but it was the location that they picked and definitely having it off site. I included the schedule of events, the timeline that we went over so that there wasn't confusion, that the walkthrough would be at 5:30, which is similar to the start time of many high school activities like games and different things like that. We recognize that parents have various work schedules. Some parents only work nights and can never come to any of that stuff. Some parents work weekends, and so you're never, again, all those gray areas, right? You're never gonna meet everybody's schedules. The goal is to have a 6:15 departure to the venue. They are renting charter buses so that all the kids can travel safely and together. 6:15 departure for a 7 o'clock arrival. We would start with dinner. It's a buffet style dinner, so there will be a lot of different things that the kids get to pick that they want. And I think I also included somewhere there's, you know, all the soda and all that stuff is included. We anticipate we'd get there, they'd eat, that would probably be about the first hour, and then from 8 to 11 they'd have their music and dancing and all of those kinds of things. Pictures. Our goal would be to return to East Hill for the post-prom party by 11:45. And then the post-prom party would begin at midnight. Now I put 6 because that's what we did this year, but even during the post-prom last year I had a conversation with Mrs. Hammonds that I felt really bad for some of the kids who tried to hang on, like as tough as they could until 5 a.m. for the pulling prizes. And like kids were coming up, they're just like, Miss Gleason, I can't do it anymore. I gotta go home. And then their name would be drawn and they'd miss out. So even we have talked about maybe doing the prizes at like 4:30 and having kids be done at 5. I know. I was still comatose at 4:30, but the kids seemed to, some of them anyway, were still up and going. So we've talked about different. That might be an earlier end time, but that has nothing to do with the night. It has to do with the fact that everyone's exhausted. The prom is not a fundraiser, it's an event. The students have worked hard to this point to raise money. They also have fundraisers scheduled for the fall to further assist with costs associated with the prom and the senior trip. Even just this week they were in because they have been on the waiting list to park cars at the fair. The guy called and they had a cancellation and they let classes do it. And for one day of parking cars, you make $1,000 for your class. So they're very excited. So there's an extra $1,000, right? Good deal. The date of May 19th has been secured for the event because, you know, they presented and they were told yes. So at this particular venue, only Fridays are available for prom. Saturdays are reserved for weddings. Students will be required to attend school that day in order to attend prom. However, which, as I have the student handbook here, it says that's true for all activities. A student can't participate in any activity if they aren't in attendance at school. And truthfully, in my past life, whether we had the prom on Friday or Saturday, which we had both, you had to be in school on Friday to go to a Saturday event too. So either way. However, again, we recognize that some students may need additional time to prepare. So we discussed that the students would need to be in school at least until 11, and at that time, if parents or guardians chose to release students from school for the remainder of the day, they'd need to follow the same early release procedures we do, which is you have to send in a note or you have to call and talk to the nurse and then give permission for your student to be released. And we talked about a lot of different possibilities for the second half of the day. you know, like doing a STAR activity that's geared to some of our underclassmen. We even talked about bringing the eighth graders up to have them participate, or maybe do that as part of their transition program. Because this year we didn't do the shadowing because we heard from some of the teachers that it didn't work out as well. So we have some thoughts about what we would do with that afternoon for the students who are in school. We talked about transportation will be provided. Students will take a charter bus from the high school to the venue. This provides a safe way for the class to travel to the prom together. It also means that students do not need to rent limos to have group transportation to the location. Additionally, this means students will be delivered directly to the post-prom party where they can change and get right to the evening's activities. In my opinion, there was a lot of downtime this year between the two because prom got out at 11 and post-prom really didn't start till midnight. And I get that some kids go home and change, but that makes me nervous. So this means we would bring them back. Everybody would go through one entrance at East Hill. There will be a place to change for the girls and the boys. And on that evening, the boys turn their tuxedos back in if they rented them through the guy that comes to school anyway, and we recollect them. So we would continue that same path. The students hope this event will create a greater sense of community. All the students who attend will spend the entire evening together by including the dinner. We also hope this means that students will stay the entire evening at the prom, dancing and socializing with their classmates as they enjoy the location. The exact cost per ticket has not been determined, but it was agreed upon that the most students would be charged is 50. I think there was some confusion because they said 50, but they said about 50, but their intention is not to go over 50. This includes the dinner, which, as I said, is a buffet-style meal with dessert and soda bar. It also includes transportation to the picturesque venue, as well as a fully decorated facility and musical entertainment. That's quite the deal, I think, for $50. I want to go. Oh, wait! I get to go. The class advisor spoke to the SAD advisors about the change to Friday night. The post-prom party will continue as it always has. Again, however, there will be less downtime between the two events. Students will be provided with locations to change on site. The boys already returned their tuxedos, so that practice will continue. We will also have a bag check to keep everyone's things secure. I think that's everything.
Thank you.
Can I ask a question of the two students?
Yes, sir.
Were you at the meeting?
I was not.
Were you at the meeting? So you didn't vote.
No.
You didn't vote. Okay.
And honestly, I feel like that was abuse of a little power because I feel like they didn't reach out to some of the students, and I feel like they needed to do that, and I feel like we needed to have a bigger vote than just the class officers.
It wasn't just the class officers. The class officers held a class meeting.
Oh, okay.
And like all of our class meetings, during guided studies, usually the week of, the advisors will put in an announcement and say, on this day during 10th period, we're having a class meeting. And the truth is, you're right, you don't get everybody. You try to get as many students as possible and the most representative sample. So typically for like the junior class meetings, they do it at the end of they did it at the end of that 10th period because then the students were back from VOTEC as well. And those students could attend too.
Do you know how many people were in the meeting?
I don't, and I didn't ask.
But everyone was invited.
But the way they described it to me was it was when they were taking care of some of the stuff with the Krispy Kremes. So there were students there who had been doing the fundraising and helping with the fundraising and all that stuff. So I didn't ask for a count.
The students that I would have been able to talk to that were present didn't feel like it was a vote either. So I just question whether we can actually call it a vote of the senior class on what they want. That's the first thing I think that's an issue. Second thing I think that's an issue is last time in our board meeting, we didn't know anything about an early release, and we verbally stated that had not been agreed to.
It had never been discussed.
Correct. So that's a problem. And then the third thing I think that's still an issue is the affordability of $50 a ticket. And what if somebody can't afford that? And how's that going to be addressed?
We had people this year who couldn't afford $25, and they were taken care of. So So the same procedures would be followed.
I think we made it clear, you know, that if any student would be excluded because of cost, then we would rescind our approval.
But there are, for some students, 25 is not affordable. A tuxedo rental, right, so we took care of those kids.
Yeah, if any student would be excluded because of cost, then we would not approve it.
But at the same time, to have it somewhere else, they're not going to spend the thousands of dollars on decorations in a DJ. It's already part of this event, which means the fundraising they've done up to this point.
They can help pay for it.
Help pay for this, and maybe reduce the cost for everybody to some degree.
I understand that as long as we have a process in place.
Right. Typically, students have an adult in the building with whom they feel comfortable enough to say, even if it's not one of the class advisors, it might be the social worker, whatever, that they would say, and I have kids who will come to me for a variety of things and say, I really wanted that t-shirt that they're all ordering, but I can't get one. And we find a way to make sure that student has the money to get it. And the same is true with prom.
I would ask student representatives in talking to your classmates about this problem. What is your feelings and what are the feelings of your classmates about this decision?
Oh, you're asking this on the spot right now?
Yeah.
All right, well, there are a couple people like that I've talked to. I don't know, I really raised questions to some of my friends about like having a prom in a different spot. But some of them I've talked to, some of them really, really don't care for it. Some of them don't care if it's going to be wherever they're still going to go. And some of them just like fear they're going to be excluded because of the cost.
I've talked to some of my friends, and some of my friends have liked the idea, and some of my friends are totally against the idea. I am totally down for having prom somewhere else, just because to have it at the school. I was a little nervous about everyone eating at the same place, but if it's all organized or anything, I don't know. I'm not disagreeing for it. Like, if they say it won't exceed $50, then I will be down.
I feel like our class is very split between. That's what it seems like to me, at least.
And how do you feel about it being Friday instead of a Saturday?
Like me, myself?
Both of
you. It really isn't impacting me, I guess. It's fine.
Ask Carolyn, though, because guys just put a suit.
They don't care.
I'm pretty sure my parents will let me out, but yeah, I would definitely need the extra time.
Well, that plus pictures, plus things that I think you need to think about, right?
I'm sure the teachers would be reasonable too, if they want to assign us a lot of homework or any of that.
I think realistically, Mr. Hill was correct. People are going to leave school because they're going to go and get their hair done. They're going to go and do the last minute things. And I don't think that was presented to us, and we clearly didn't approve that. So I think that's an issue. I haven't done a detailed exploration. I've talked to five or six juniors that would have supposedly been invited to this meeting, and nobody was at the meeting. I asked my daughter to find somebody that was and ask, was it a vote? And they said no. It was kind of presented as, this is what we're planning on doing. Does anybody object? And that was the way it was presented. It wasn't.
Anyone object?
Exactly.
Did they?
No.
Nobody said it.
No. But I don't take that as a vote that people can say, okay, the majority of the class wants to do this or not. And by your own admission, the class is pretty divided, so I think it needs to be something that they agree to.
To cancel the venue now.
Oh, I don't know.
What's the, there'll be a fiscal impact?
I don't know. I don't know.
I'm just asking because I think that's a piece of,
yeah.
I mean, that, I'm just curious about that information.
Because they, I know they had to put money down to secure the date and sign the thing, and I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know that answer.
I was just curious.
I can find out.
I think doing a Friday night and being presumptive that they're going to be let out of school and not presenting that to the board.
They did talk about it. The kids
yeah.
did talk
they
about
did
it.
They did talk
in
about
the
it.
Meeting.
Yeah.
They did.
Maybe
at the
get
previous
school
meeting.
Early.
Right. I don't know yeah. that it was.
Well, they also
they
suggested,
meant,
they, one of the suggestions they made was, would it be possible for there to be a different activity at the high school that afternoon? As opposed
no,
to class, like a modified schedule for the day for the high school. They did talk about that. And having something else for the, like having a PD day for the teachers in the afternoon or whatever. They did talk about having a modified schedule at the high school.
I don't know that it was explicit, we're going to get out early, but they did
right.
talk about. And the reality is, if it's here, they're not in class either because they're decorating. So,
true.
So
the advisors,
no matter
both
what,
advisors, and I'd say, what did we have, like 15 or so, 20 kids last year?
Yeah.
Missed the full day,
yeah.
they the Friday. To decorate for the Saturday. Which, and again, I mean, maybe to me it didn't seem like, I come from a place where we always had Friday. So it didn't, it, you know, I didn't, it, and we there are places around us who have done Fridays. So I maybe didn't advise them correctly either in some of the things they needed to share out, although they did the presentation on their own. That certainly wasn't for me. But because I come from a place where we always had a Friday dance, a Friday, the senior event was the last Friday of classes, always. So the kids always got out and went and did their thing and got ready, and it was just part of what happened.
So why can't we potentially have the officers take their PowerPoint presentation and do something either the first or second day of school to the entire class, because they'll all be here that, hopefully. And honestly, we want the juniors to be part of this too, not that they get to maybe vote, although they're an integral part of this if we want to have 100 people there, that the junior class should be
part
in agreement with doing
yeah.
this too.
You know, and the,
I
would
asking.
Say my experience in general with this kind of thing is, you're gonna put those announcements out there and kids are gonna come and some aren't.
Right.
And kids are going to vote and some aren't. And the same was true even the best we tried to do for the elections to get kids out and sit them all in here and say to kids, no, you're staying until we're done and give me your ballot. And some of the kids hand you a blank ballot back. You know what I'm saying? So
raise your hand and take
No, no, no. I know. I'm just saying,
to, you know,
we can do all those things. You're just, you know, you're still going to get the, but I mean, I can inform them to do that. I think the problem is going to be if it's something that they're not going to be able to do, the sooner, I mean, financially speaking, I don't know how much they had to put down as a deposit or how much they had to guarantee, or you know how they do, like sometimes
right.
by this
yeah,
date you get this much back.
At the same time, the sooner they know that this is what's going to happen for the prom and they know they need $50 for their ticket,
right.
they've got from September to May
to save
come
up
with it. Or do the fundraising to help come up with it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it needs to be clear that that this Friday night schedule is there. There are a lot of traditions here of pictures over at Arkell and in the afternoon. None of that's going to happen unless you do it at 3 o'clock on
well,
Friday.
None of that's going to happen. That's not going to happen.
Or it
right.
could, but it's going to change what parents
that, that
are doing
is,
that day.
Is
correct. You know, so I think it needs to be informative.
Mm-hmm.
And
also,
people need to make
parents like this ahead. Maybe they can get off. Like maybe not the whole day. This could be like a trying thing. Like we'll try it on a Friday and see if it doesn't work or if it does work. I mean, prom's not necessarily about the place where it takes place. It's about like who you experience it with. So I don't know if that's like, but it is a important part.
So are we in agreement that we will request that the senior class, incoming senior class, hold a full meeting with the entire class and have a vote? After a presentation with all the information, the that Ms. Gleason has just, you know, given us.
And just, this came from the advisors too. This is all their stuff that they gave to me, so I don't want to take ownership. I'm just.
No. I'm saying that they can present all this.
Yeah.
A full picture, and then have a vote of the students to reaffirm or to change their decision.
How would you like that to happen? What's the best inclusive way?
Best way? Probably get them in the morning.
Yeah.
First or second day of school, seriously.
Paper ballots handed to everybody.
Well, don't forget, we're going to have seniors who have late arrival. So we probably won't know the best time until we.
It would seem most inclusive if there was actually something that we could ensure that got in everybody's hand for them to.
Choose to deposit or not.
Right, exactly. Because of different schedules, like you're saying, you know, somebody goes to BOCES in the morning or whatever, you know, or they happen to have a dentist appointment that day or whatever it is, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, we have advisors and officers, and the advisors are paid. I would suggest that the advisors may have a way to do that, and that we should let them.
Perfectly fine.
Have a way to do that because that is their role.
And I think we should make sure that everybody gets something in their hand to have the opportunity.
And if they don't turn it back in, I mean,
that's on them. That's an abstention.
Yep.
That's right.
Maybe something just as simple as like having it when you walk in the door.
Well, I think that if you've got those ideas, you could share those with your class officers. I mean, because again, that's peer-to-peer, and I think that makes some sense, or with the class advisor, but certainly with your class officers.
I would second your motion. I think you made a motion. I'd second
it. I made a motion, let's say that within the first week of school, a meeting be held of all the seniors so that a vote can be taken. And any seniors that are unable to be at that meeting because of scheduling, be given a ballot of some sort that they can enter.
Yes. We will figure it out. We will figure it out. And you said something more informative for the juniors.
Well, you should figure out a way to do it electronically.
Cool.
A Twitter poll.
There you go.
But then how are you going to make sure everybody...
That's true. Never mind.
Well, but you're not... But you give everybody paper and they, you know... No, but there'll be some way. I was just, you know...
I mean, I'm sure you figured out the best way to do it.
Right. I think that the
just
teachers...
Just some have. Democratic...
Right.
Clear democratic decision.
Now, prior to that, do we also need to do the more informative thing for juniors? Or do we save the informative things for juniors until we know for sure which we're doing?
I think the latter. Still second in motion, Mark.
I think Mrs. Van Heusen has it. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Let's move on to 10:20, folks. That's my bedtime. John's waiting for you.
Don't you mind that?
John's
waiting by now.
Probably. Next is the Smart Schools Investment Plan.
This should be relatively quick, I hope. I presented the plan last week. The question came up about the provision of hotspots for students who don't have access to internet at home. Smart Schools money can only support hardware and not the service. So what I would suggest is that we move ahead with the Smart Schools investment plan as it is, and we use district funds to support if there is a need for hotspots, which we would determine by surveying our community in the fall.
That's as succinct as I can make it.
Because the next step is that the Smart Schools investment plan has to be posted on the website for 30 days.
Okay. Spend time reviewing it with us the next time.
Yeah. Oh, yes. I went through all of this.
Okay.
Had all the presentations.
It was a whole presentation with much detail. But the question was about students and how we might provide hotspots to students. And that's just we would have to do it through district funds.
Gotcha.
For the purchase stuff, are you bringing back details? I'm just trying to refresh my memory of what we're going to order. Or
the amount?
Yes.
Well, yes, and I would do that. Right, and that would be if we post this for 30 days, then, because then the board has to, it's an upfront cost. If you remember, this is a reimbursable piece. So we want to have the details of what the cost is. What we order is based on our district protocol and what we have been ordering for technology.
Yeah, in terms of that.
Right, in terms of that, but the money stuff, yes, absolutely.
We have to have a motion on that?
No, is this just really, this is just a follow-up, because Mark had asked for it, and if there's, unless there's some other change to what the purchase plan would be, which we are going for installments. Because we really want this posted, because we really want to get more computers.
Post away.
Okay. And then in September, I'll make sure that we have the, at the first meeting in September, that you have the dollar amounts attached to it, because now we'll be able to go out and spec out the bids in anticipation of hiring the first group of staff. Which is the technical term, stuff, for technology equipment. I like your technical terms, I know. Okay, thank you for the update.
Can I make a motion that we go to executive session?
Can I ask you to make a motion to go into exec, if needed for the purpose of qualification of particular persons? That'd be great.
Now you can. She makes me say that every time. Open meetings law requires that you state the purpose for executive session. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, everybody.